not represent all these other
We are here.
What up?
We are back at Fan Club.
I feel like it's been forever. I know it's just been a week.
It does. It does.
Okay, it's not just me.
No. Even this weekend feels like it was weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
Like 1,000%. But we're back. It's TWG Fan Club, our weekly wrestling fan club, live on Twitch every Wednesday. I want to give a shout out to my crew, who joins me every week, and also, of course, my other half and my sister, KRISTA B, who is cooking up a lot of things behind the scenes for TWG that we are very excited about. I'm also very excited about this show because it is something that I never thought would be happening on our programming. Hey, Keith. Is we are having an AEW appreciation night, an All Elite Wrestling appreciation night. And I want to just put one thing out there before I continue with some announcements. We, TWG, never hated AEW. Hey, Rakasha. We respect the fact that there's another promotion. We love that there's an option out there. And I think if you can't respect what AEW did this past weekend as a wrestling fan, it's kind of like, do you really love wrestling? Or you know, because this was a very magical weekend for the wrestling business in general, especially after such tragedies. Rest in peace to Wyndham, aka Bray Wyatt, Terry Funk. It's been a rough week. So, you know, this past weekend was definitely magical. For all of us wrestling fans, shout out to Mercedes Moné, who still manages to be the topic of conversation, like no matter what. Mm-hmm. But we will get all into All In later on in the show for hashtag AEW Appreciation Night. So call all your AEW fans, hashtag TWG Fan Club, tell them to come to Twitch because we are going to talk about all of our favorite moments and what we love about AEW. Hey, Dylan. Hey, Andre. So before we get into all of that, I want to remind everyone that there is a new episode of TWG out right now. It dropped on Monday. It is an interview with the one and only Cam Hawkins, aka Seahawk, on Twitter. It is a very inspirational conversation. I get to know him more than I ever have. And I feel like, you know, I've known him in the social media world for a long time. But I was able to kind of pick his brain a little bit and see how he got into this crazy IWC and how he became one of the most well-known people in this space and a writer for The Ringer. You know, he does it all. I'm not going to read off his resume, but make sure you follow him if you're not following him already. Go to our YouTube channel and check out our interview with him. It is amazing. Shout out to KRISTA B for setting up these amazing interviews with some of the most amazing people in this space. So check that out. A new season of TWG is coming next month. That's right, we're back with live episodes on Twitch.
The old US.
Here's a clip. Oh, or maybe not. But September 9th, we will start our live episodes again, which I was so excited about before. We have a whole list of subjects that we're going to cover. But I think what we love most about the live episodes is that Twitch allows us to have you guys a part of them. So that is probably one of the most amazing and special things about our live episodes. So that is coming back. There are new episodes of Schoolin' with Krista B and Pablo the Don on YouTube. That series actually goes back to being Patreon exclusive next month. So if you have not checked them out, check them out on YouTube, subscribe, and then subscribe to our Patreon. I mean, it's $1 a month. It helps us buy wrestling t-shirts and go to wrestling shows. And I think you guys all love when we can do that because we come back here and we spill the tea. So support the brand, support a lot of other podcasts out there that are doing their thing, especially my fellow YouTuber Justin Rich and Siendole, who have been killing it in the content creating space, putting in a lot of hard work and a lot of time. And I do not ignore that. I appreciate everything that you guys do. Please check them out. They'll be talking more about what they have going on, of course, later on in the show. But we are a family. TWG is a family, and it's not just Krista B and I a lot of the time. It's a big group of people. Shout out to the group chat. Shout out to wrestling friends and family that we meet in this space. You know, check in on people. Shout out to Mike. Another friend that I met in this space, check in on people, because as we've learned last week, life is fucking short and you just never fucking know. So please just check in and use social media for positive, like not negative. And whether that's on Threads or formerly known as Twitter, like it's always just good to put positivity out in the world. So how are you guys doing? Before we take a break and get into all that we have to talk about, because it is a jam-packed show, I heard from our producer. How are you guys? You guys ready to get into things?
I'm good. Been a busy day. Actually, been a busy week, but it's Wednesday. It's the middle of the week, middle of the day, and I am ready to spend some positivity. It's been a lot of negative talk in wrestling, but I'm ready to have a positive talk. I see the chat is on fire already.
Hey, Christina.
Ready for the smoke.
All the smoke.
Yeah, but I've taken a peep at the rundown, so I'm really excited because there we go. Yeah,
I think we can officially start the show now. You know,
I was wondering where he was at. I'm like, it's like 5 minutes past, about to start charging at the door. I don't see Noah up. There he is.
Nah, he sent me a message. But today, I'm gonna put it out there, Noah. He sent me a message today about how, you know, when Undertaker cleared the ring to go against Shawn Michaels and he hit his head straight on the ground. Ooh. He said, Omos wouldn't have never done that.
Yo, shout out to the Omos Sapiens.
This is my wish for 2024. So we're gonna make it happen. Noah meet Omos. That's what one of my wishes is. We're gonna put that. Krista B hit the cue. We need that like a sound bite, but like put it in the notes. But that's my wish, one of my wishes. That's what we should do. Fan club wishes for 2024.
Ooh, I love that. I can't believe we're in the last quarter of the year where we're already thinking of like stuff for the next year.
Mm-hmm. I'm writing it in a doc.
Love that for you. Love that for you. But I am excited to get into, I like talking about things that we haven't talked about on this platform. You know, we're going into 5 years. You heard what Krista B said, Justin. You know, it's been 5 years. Save the date. November 4th is the official date for our 5th anniversary event here in New York City. And going into that, you know, you tend to, especially in a niche topic, because we only talked about women for a long time, you talk about a lot of the same shit. So tonight, it's going to be very refreshing to talk about AEW in a way that we never have before. So everyone in the comments, in the fan club, what do you appreciate about AEW? What is some of your favorite things about the promotion, Dynamite, wrestlers, all of the above? We're going to get into all of that. But I am more hype about my girl Siendole Scoreboard. Because she is back rating some of the women's matches. You know, women's match that was at
Was that a layered comment?
Let me get this shade out now and then we could go into the fan club.
You mean the one that they had time for, you know?
I believe there were over 10 matches.
Yeah, and they had like gave us a nice measly couple of minutes. How awesome. Can't wait to talk about it.
Oh my god.
But fun, thank god fun. There was another awesome pay-per-view that happened with our girl and another two other matches that happened. So I rated those as well. But we're gonna get into
the beautiful thing is I already talked about this whole women's division situation with AEW on Turnbuckle Talk. So now this can be a clear out for you guys.
Oh, I'm sure. And you guys really get into it on that channel, by the way, Justin, which I really appreciate. Mm-hmm.
But I'm glad you brought up. We definitely got into it this
week. A lot.
Replays
on Twitter, that's all I got to say.
There were some things that were said, and there was some Tony Khan. You may have to come to the front of the line because not only does Chris B have to check you, we had to check you real quick.
Ooh, yeah. Okay.
A lot of checking. I caught the replay this morning, and I was like,
I mean, things need to be said. You know, these things need to be commented on in a certain way. Oh, they'll be said.
Yeah, they'll be said.
Oh, yeah, we ain't done. I have
a lot of smoke for my rating, so it's going to be okay.
Oh, I will. I know somebody does. Well, shout out to Impact because we are going to try to be there next week, 2 weeks from now, whatever. Oh, my God, I think it is next week. We are going to try to be there. That'll be our first Impact show. Hashtag TrendPack. Hashtag Awesome yet? Kong is back. Like, there's Gail Kim. Oh, my God, there's so many things. So we'll get into Impact first, I think, after the break. Siendole with your scoreboard. Then we'll get into All In. And then we'll lead into our very special night, which is giving AEW their props. So during this break, everyone in the VIP, in the fan club, tweet, Instagram, whatever. Tell all your friends, all the wrestling fans that you know that love AEW to come through to the fan club because we want to talk about all of it. And yes, Noah, I'm glad you brought that up. I want to say Queens or Long Island.
White Plains.
There you go. Yep. Fake Bronx. Yes, it will be there. So we definitely going to try to figure some shit out. I mean, come on. Is there any, I mean, this would be the perfect event to be Krista B and I's first Impact show. Okay. Like, I mean, there is no other one to go to. We get to see the new Knockouts champion, which is, of course, our girl, Trinity. So we in there like swimwear. Okay. Dylan said he has thoughts on the All In Women's Four Way. Let's get into it. So let's take a break. Mm-hmm. And we will get right back into the Impact scoreboard that Siendo has for us for that women's match.
Don't go too far. You only got about 30 seconds.
The Rock discovered her based on the documentary about her family. And like her brothers wanted to be champions in WWE. And she was the one that was a star. And you can clearly see like Paige had something even at that young age. And that's why this episode is titled The One and Only, because there's no one like Paige. So The Rock discovers her and was like, I want to make a movie about you. Imagine having a biopic and you're not even like 25. Like that has to be like mind blowing.
Yes, a callback to our Saraya / Paige spotlight. We made that, I think, last year. She might have just signed with AEW or maybe just made
she
her
wasn't
comeback.
Signed yet. That was the summer of 2022.
Got you. Yeah. So I was missing my girl Saraya. So we did a spotlight on her finally. It was really good. So check that out on YouTube and all of the podcast platforms. And I cannot wait to get into her title win later on. But first, it's time for Siendole scoreboard. We are going to start with Impact. And I'm going to let Siendole explain the criteria and let us know what to expect. Girl, do your thing.
Do I get some music? Ooh. Yay. All right. Y'all already know what the deal is. It's after a long hiatus of being away for a little bit, gave the women a little bit of respect. There's a lot of matches going on and a lot of me going on, but we're back. We're back with the scoreboard. And as you know, producer dropped my credentials on the screen, if you will, so that we can remind the people what we're looking at here. Siendole scoreboard is always rated by a match long longevity. See how long I've been out in the game. I can't even say longevity. Chemistry, wrestling ability, and storyline buildup. And if we're going to go on storyline buildup, let us start with a match that I don't think a lot of people were really paying attention to, but one that I definitely paid attention to. Let's start with the Knockouts Tag Team Championships, if we can. So you had an interesting four dynamic four-way, a nice fatal four-way for the Knockouts Tag Team Champions. And I actually like this match because of the tag teams that were in. Now, if y'all don't know, if y'all watch Impact, and shout out to anybody in the comments who's going to mention that they have. If you haven't, it's okay. You can catch up with us. But MK Ultra is the team of Misha Slamovich and Killer Kelly. They had a dog collar match a couple of months ago that was one of the best women's matches, if anything, on an episode of Impact Wrestling. And from there, they decided to form an alliance. They took out Kelly King and another person, I can't remember the name of this person right now, sorry, to become the new Knockouts Tag Team Champions at the last pay-per-view, which was Slammiversary. So now we're building up from Slammiversary. You have all these tag teams are starting to develop. You have the Death Dolls. You also have the Quintessential Diva Tag Team, which is the tag team of Savannah Evans and Giselle Shaw, and all four of these women. Oh, and actually, Kelly King's original tag team partner got attacked backstage. So that's the interesting storyline buildup. And that's when you have Jody Threat entering the chat with this match. But it, all in all, the ladies did not miss with the chemistry. It was a great buildup towards, because on Impact, they were arguing as to why, you know, MK Ultra is even are the tag team champions in the first place. It's sketchy, you know, but they're weird. I like their chemistry. They're kind of like, there it's just it's interesting. If you gotta pay attention to it to understand why it grows on me to like MK Ultra. But all in all, this match didn't miss. It was a lot of high flying. Of course, y'all know I'm always impressed by Miss Giselle Shaw, and her and Savannah Evans seem to work perfectly as a tag team together. You even had the Death Dolls put on all these high defiant matches. So all in all, I gave it a 4.6. In a world where there's only another company that has another tag team championship that we rarely get to talk about because we rarely get to see it defended on pay-per-view, and yes, that's shade, it was nice to see that on this pay-per-view they were keeping up tradition and defending the Knockouts Tag Team Championships with this match. So I want to ask the fan club, do you think that the Knockouts Tag Team Championship is worth the watch?
I want to give it an opportunity. When you look at, you know, women's wrestling being showcased, you know, I don't mind like when the belt play hot potato and stuff, but you know, I want to give this an opportunity, especially Savannah Evans over there, who,
right,
well, Birdie told me might be seeing her on a couple other screens.
Tease.
Okay, okay.
So I'm definitely interested because, like, I know we've talked about WWE and the influx of their women's tag team division and everything that's gone on with that for like the last year plus, where it's like it basically needs an exorcism. So I'm down for like alternatives to that, especially with more women's wrestling and good women's wrestling. Sign me up.
Mm-hmm. Hey, what are your thoughts?
I'm honestly just here for big matches on pay-per-views for women. So it's just like, you know, one of those things where it's like, you know what? They got time. It was a decent match. I'm here for it.
Now, I gave it the 4.6 because I did, if it wasn't for me watching Slammiversary and realizing it was a lot of new at Slammiversary, without knowing, was a lot of new, like a lot of title switch hands.
Mm-hmm.
And the tag team championship, like people didn't think that, you know, Killer Kelly and Misha Slamovich's feud was already on fire even before. And there you go. It was the Covenant. So their feud was already on one. It was already interesting even before Slammiversary. So to see them, they had this, first of all, that dog collar match, y'all have to go back and watch that. That was intense in itself for two women to have that type of match. Like, because, you know, dog collar, we like to save that stuff for the men. And this was one of those first time I was like, okay, well, women could do this too. It was just like another list of, okay, anything men could do, women could do. And those two excelled in that match. So for them to then turn around and become a tag team, it was like, oh, this makes sense. But I was like, oh wait, shit, this makes sense, because both them bitches crazy, let's be real. Like, the way they be looking on their promo, even if you look at their promo cut, dude, somebody was like, and Kiss. Out in my head, I'm like, and Kiss. But then at the same time, I'm like, and they about to fuck people up. So even
the Mike Tyson meme.
Yeah, like
Nackies.
So I can literally see them working. I don't see them being a transitional tag team. I see them being the tag team that's like unstoppable in a sense. So this makes me excited to watch the Knockouts, that part of Knockouts division, even more. Because like I said, they don't like, for some reason, the other company don't want to put over tag team belts yet. And I understand people like to associate it with being cursed, but I don't think the Knockouts tag team championship has that thing, because they're trying to obviously make it work. This will work.
Mm-hmm.
But speaking of belts, let's go on to the next belts. Let's talk about the belt we've been waiting since our girl Trinity has crossed over to the Impact Zone. And this is the match that we've all been waiting for. This is match number 3 on my dream list for her. So we're talking about Deonna Purrazza versus Trinity, baby. Did not disappoint. I mean, like I said, if you watch Slammiversary, you kind of saw the writing on the wall. You saw Trinity being champion, but the question was Deonna Purrazza going to keep up her antics and keep and level up her craft against our girl, bring our craft to the best? But you kept hearing the crowd. They're interested in seeing our girl Trinity, because there's nothing like Trinity. There's been nothing like Trinity in Impact for a very long time. And we all know that Deonna Purrazza is a technician. She's one of the best technicians they got on that roster, period, bar none, which is why she's been able to excel the way she was since she landed in the Impact Zone in the indie industry. But she's met her match. So, but the match wasn't good enough. She's still your Impact champion, ladies and gentlemen. I found it great between the techniques and the high flying. And Deonna, actually, you could tell since their homework, because she was able to counter a lot of Trinity's moves, mm-hmm. which was kind of nail biting. I like that. That's what gave it to 4.7, because like I said, we've kind of been waiting for this. When Deonna Purrazza walked out the first time, I was like, listen, I'm glad you're here. I'm happy that I have somebody that, you know, can match my style. But let's see if you could take this from me. And sis took it from her. And now Deonna Purrazza is like, let me see if I can get it back, because I think I get it back. Even though she didn't get it back, shout out to Deonna Purrazza. This is one of the best matches that Impact has had today. I mean, you had Gail Kim looking like a whole icon, just doing the commentary justice the way that nobody can do the commentary justice. I mean, that match to me earns this 4.7. Y'all tell me what you think. Do you think now the next eyeball is supposed to be Miss Jordynne Grace? Do you think our girl Trinity is ready for the challenge? Or do you just see it as another one bites the dust? Trinity stays our Impact champion once more, and we're waiting for something bigger.
Real quick, Siendole, if you don't mind, one of the things I do want to touch on about the match is the fact that you had, just like we talked about it at WrestleMania, so we got to talk about it here. You have two women in the main event, obviously, but you have referee Allison Lee, and then you have ring announcer Jade Chung. So, I mean, just... It's sad that this stuff is like becoming a first and a big deal in 2023, but better late than never. It's just like, you know, we would say when we had like two black coaches in the Super Bowl in 2007, you know, like we're glad to see these moments, but I definitely want to point that out and celebrate that. And with the addition, like you said, Gail Kim at the commentary booth doing her thing as well. If anybody, like, I think Gail Kim is a Hall of Famer in both companies, not just Impact, but WWE as well. I don't think she'll ever get the WWE justice. But, you know, overall, this is exciting. I've been very vocal about I'm more of a fan of Deonna Purrazza in Impact Wrestling. Our EP says everybody doesn't need the championship. Everybody doesn't need to be in WWE, right? Everybody doesn't need to be in NXT. We've seen a lot of times, I mean, you see it in sports all the time, where one player, insert X player, does better. Like Geno Smith was the Jets quarterback, and he wasn't good. but then mm-hmm. he became a Pro Bowl quarterback where he was in college, essentially, in Seattle, right? And you see that a lot of times. Mm-hmm. Look at, you know, even some of the wrestlers, you see them do better on the main roster. You're like, wait, they couldn't cook in NXT, Zoe Stark. Right. But then they get to the main roster. And so different things. Sometimes it's just chemistry. Sometimes it's just the system. And I think the system works for Deonna Purrazzo. Now, Trinity Fatu. Trinity, I say Trinity Fatu is the human being. Hello? Oh,
you good?
I heard somewhere noises. I don't know who's, Trinity Fatu, the human being, the person. She can cook anywhere. Put her on any show, anywhere. She's phenomenal. So I'm excited.
Same.
I actually have a question for Justin.
What up?
Du-du-dum.
Now, Justin, I know you're going to talk. I know you talk a little bit about pay-per-view wise. Do you think with this level of pay-per-view now, with the level of matches production-wise, for pay-per-views, do you think Impact now, they also announced, interesting enough, they also announced that on their Twitter that they're going to make a lot of changes now production-wise to bring you more high-quality things. But do you think Impact needs that? Or do you think they're just doing that because they now know they have the high level of talent to draw a crowd?
I think they need to do that because presentation matters. Like, you see it in WWE as far as like someone's entrance, the jumbotron, to the music, to the lights, to how they're presented. AEW, the same thing. Even New Japan, when you Tokyo Dome hits and they get the special entrances and whatnot, like how you come out, how you're presented means a big deal on whether we take you seriously or not. Like, look at how New Japan presented Mercedes Moné at Wrestle Kingdom. They gave her a grand entrance. They made like a humongous deal of like, holy shit, we never have women on this card. Now, not only do you have a women's match, but we're premiering a brand new women's wrestler in the middle of this, their WrestleMania, stuff like that. So the presentation does matter. And it's only going to benefit Impact because last time, you know, they were going that route with the presentation and whatnot and trying to really get new eyes. I go back to Final Deletion, where everyone was fucking like, yo, how do I pull this up? How do I watch this? It's this word of mouth, like, yo, I need to go watch this. And then they tried a couple other times after that, and people were still like, yo, I'm invested. I want to watch this. How do I get into this Hardy's compound, King Maxwell, all this shit? Like, it's only going to benefit Impact. But yeah, like, presentation does matter, though.
All right. 1,000%.
1,000%, which is why we had some interesting conversations about Impact in the beginning stages of Fan Club. But you know, things happen. We're fickle wrestling fans. We live and we learn.
We did, because we did, and I'm guilty. I'm not a liar. I'm not a crook. I found it very hard to watch that Mickie James match. Like, it was like clawing teeth. I'm like, why do they cut the good tooth? Why are they cutting here and then they're cutting left? And y'all know me, I'm a big camera person. Why y'all cutting me left when I'm supposed to see a leg drop from the right? Because the leg drop from the right makes it look more impactful when you drop that leg on the neck. Why y'all cut into her booty? I don't understand what's going on. It was a lot of camera cut. So yes,
speaking on that,
you already know how I feel
certain wrestling fans like to see booty. I'm just saying,
we do, but at the same time, like, you messing up, you messing up the effect. Like, I'm supposed to believe that, you know, the Hell's Gate is choking the hell out of somebody, right? And you show me the back of Brock Lesnar's back. That does not work for me, guys. Let's get his camera. Let's get it to the right camera, y'all. Y'all know y'all camera positions. Y'all pay a lot of money for this.
And let's just make sure we add your credibility. She's a shooter, y'all. So she knows what she's talking about.
That's what we were talking about.
Angles, everything. If you tell me your good side is on your right, I'm not going to shoot you from the left. So that's why I said what I said. But they
Sometimes they just know their audience. I just watched AEW Collision, like, this past, going into this weekend, and when they did the women's match, like 90% of the women's match, they were doing camera cuts on Saraya and Toni Storm's ass. And I was just like, I mean, you do have the rest of this match, right? But maybe they know their audience, where it's like, you know, people want to look at this shit,
you directly, know, indirectly. Act like white girls is like the fucking,
you know, it's funny. It's
holy grail.
It's so ridiculous. Like, I freaking hate it. You know, having worked with like all women, like in a women's promotion, that was one of the things that they said they enjoyed about the way, shout out to Blizz Photography, him, Brother Hugh. I know, you know, no Brother Hugh slander right now, but shout out. They loved the way we shoot because they felt comfortable. They didn't feel like they had to make sure they didn't have a wardrobe malfunction because it would be magnified, you know.
Right. No, I 100% agree. So speaking of Impact, really quickly, how does it feel that Awesome Kong will be coming back to celebrate? Like, a lot of milestone moments are reserved kind of for WWE because of their legacy. But I love that they are celebrating 1,000 episodes and there is a return that is significant. Like, I'm so excited for this.
When you cannot talk about the history of TNA wrestling, or y'all can thank Hulk Hogan for this, Impact Wrestling. I really wish it was still Total Nonstop Action. Like, it's always gonna be, you know.
Still gonna be TNA in my mind.
Yeah, but you can't talk about history knows the stuff without mentioning Awesome Kong. Yeah. Like, if you was flipping through your TV station, right, and when it was on Spike TV, and you saw, if you was watching whatever you liked on there, and then you seen her on your TV, like, whoa, wait a minute. All right, I'm going to check out insert day, let's say Thursday. I'm going to check it out Thursday night because she looked dope. And, I mean, her and Gail Kim had some of the greatest matches in wrestling history. So for her to be there, it's only right. It's only right. You can't celebrate. And shout out to them for 1,000 episodes.
Right.
You know, you go all the way back to 2002 when they were doing the pay-per-views per week. And, you know, if we got anybody that was a part of the 1099 crew, go ahead and drop that in the chat. But, you know, I mean, 999, you know, weekly. And shout out to Jeff Jarrett. I hope he's there because we don't have this promotion without him.
And it's interesting because when is Kurt Angle's documentary coming out? I think that's Monday? All within Monday? Like the same. Is it this Monday?
I want to say so because I feel like it would be like
it's gonna be one hell of a week then, because that's because you have then you have Impact. Listen, you had to be there. It's Saturday, okay. So yeah, it comes out this Saturday. Pittsburgh.
September 2nd.
Yeah, because they back in Pittsburgh. Are they back in? Yeah, because Pittsburgh. Yeah.
Yeah, Payback's in Pittsburgh. Yeah, and you also had the PLE.
You had to be there, first of all. Mm-hmm. You had to be there with the main event mafia and Booker T with that stupid ass African accent, and then they had Sting with no face paint. They had Kevin Nash.
Listen, hold on. I gotta ask you this, sis. Should main event mafia be talked about the same way DX and the NWO?
They don't get enough credit. They don't get enough credit for being for trying to be the OGs of another company. That's what got me. You realize they were OGs from different companies that came to another company trying to be their OGs. That's the whole point of the main event mafia. Like, Kurt Angle was trying to be the OG of TNA. Then, you know, Booker T was on a high because hello, you was running up people's credit cards.
We gotta have a TNA appreciation tonight, it seems. Listen,
not ran my grandmother's credit.
The way that if you were a kid, you literally used to like buy video games little by little with your grandmother or your mama's credit card. That's how TNA was running scam. That's how I'm telling you. That's how they made their money. I'm convinced.
So they're basically like BS high.
Yes.
Y'all gotta remember the time period too. You gotta remember time period. WCW had shut down a year ago, right? WWE was starting to get settled. Like Paul White said this last week during the media tour. He said Vince is the type of person who thrives off competition. Like, right. He needs that. So with Impact or TNA, you just turn on a channel, you see every week, you see names you recognize that didn't make the transition. Then slowly but surely, Sky Hall, You started seeing Sting for a one-off. And I'm pretty sure Keith can name some other people. Macho Man for a one-off. So it made you want to watch because now you get an alternative product. I remember being in school, in high school. It's crazy. I remember this. Then this, I was a ninth grader, and this person was in Brother Brandon's class. He was talking about, he was like writing a business plan, talking about he was going to give Vince McMahon competition.
Tell him, Dylan.
No, Dylan was our VIP of the fan.
He gonna send her a GIF of Keith running. He gonna send her a GIF of Keith running up the Dylan. Yo, cranking him out real quick.
Okay, we definitely gotta have a
TNA. We gotta do a TNA night impact, because this comment, the way this TNA comment section is lit up, they give me bad foyo. The way that I'm telling you, mm-hmm. we have to, because y'all will never understand. First of all, the last time I watched TNA was when they was trying to put Allie in the corner. Don't nobody put Allie in the corner, because Allie was your resident. Allie, you cheer for Allie the way you cheer for Nikki A.S.H. You cheer for her. Yo, when I tell you homegirls in the ring was like, I'm not tall and I'm not as pretty as Tiffany and I ain't as tall as Gamzee. But she's like, I'm Allie. And the crowd loved it. It was the weirdest thing. They loved them some ODB.
That's where Chelsea some Green awesome got Kong. Her going. Like her, her feet footing going.
Yes.
You know, was it Laurel Van Ness?
Listen.
The Lochness.
The Lochness, yeah.
Yeah. Impact Wrestling Appreciation Night. We did something similar, but we need to.
I don't want to know. It can't be Impact. It has to be TNA.
It has to be TNA.
Oh, my bad.
I want to hear some of the stories from the TNA. Because that was a very interesting time in wrestling.
If y'all got Tubi, not Tubi.
No, Pluto.
Pluto.
You have to have Pluto.
That's what Pluto.
You gotta get Pluto.
So many streaming services.
There's a channel on Pluto that's literally wrestling and it's all Impact all the time. I suggest you watch it. Because the fact I woke up one night and it was that promo with Jay Lethal and Ric Flair going back and forth. Yo, I realized how funny that shit is up close and personal. He was like, here's the dope. Don't be mad.
Hey, don't do start.
Is this true?
He was like, yes.
Okay, yeah, we gotta get into it. Okay, unsung. Yeah, we're getting into it soon. Mm-hmm. Yep.
We definitely doing an appreciation.
Or the Steiner Math.
Hashtag TNA appreciation night. And Steiner I don't mean math. I mean total stop.
total
nonstop action.
Right? Booker T getting in the ring. Boom. Yep. Booker T kicking the man. Boom.
The real question Booker T's out of Creed. You have the TNA video game. I understand you had SmackDown vs. Raw 2006. But did you have the TNA video game? That joint was trash. But you know, it wasn't on the level of the WWE games. But they tried. You know, they tried. AJ feud with Abyss. Abyss is another one who's often slept on because you know. And then when he became Joseph Park and all that, man.
Yeah.
All
right. So,
I mean, the world's famous AJ Styles, Christopher Daniels, that triple threat. That's TNA, right?
Son, beer money. Dude, we gotta do a night. We gotta do it.
I'm saying it right now. Justin, take note. Next week is we recap the summer in wrestling because it's been a busy summer, right? And then the week after that, it is officially hashtag TNA Appreciation Night. And I will reiterate, it's not Impact. I want to go into those first years of when it was TNA, six-sided ring, the cum shirts. Like, I want to talk about all of that.
What?
No, we got to talk. We're going to talk about TNA. We're going to talk about Tyra versus Mickie James.
Okay.
Yes, we are, Nikki Bouski. Hey, okay, we're going to talk about it.
I want to also just shout out Nikki Bougie, one of our favorite people in the space who has been killing it. I don't know how she does it all. She literally is on a roll going to everything.
I'm trying to be like her.
Reporting all the tapings and all the wrestlers. She's amazing. Check her out on Women's Wrestling Talk. I know she has a lot in store. We might have to have Nikki as a special guest for maybe the TNA Appreciation Night.
It can't be a thing. She has more here.
They be knowing.
She have a lot to say. I know it.
The fact
that she just brought up Rosemary and Jade.
See?
But that's so Impact, that's Impact.
We could talk into the evolution of, because I feel like when it comes to TNA, it's like what AEW, we're going to bounce back into AEW. You have to remember what it was back then. The reason why people are so excited about it in the comments because like what WWE was going through when AEW was developing, the same thing was happening when TNA was developing and it became that alternative. Like if I wasn't in, like I loved women's wrestling back then, but if it wasn't giving what it was supposed to give, half honey, Velvet Sky, and Angelique and Medicine Ray as beautiful people had me in a choke hold because I knew they was going to cause some havoc. I said, all right, the Divas ain't doing nothing but doing mud baths and stuff. And Candice Michelle ain't there because they don't have a defend the championship for some reason. I'm watching TNA and they were good TNA while screen. Doing it too. That was yeah,
like, so the Dudleys put in a Dixie Carter through a table. That's TNA, all right? I want to make sure that's TNA versus Impact.
That's TNA.
Yes,
TNA. Okay. I figured that was because that was a Impact huge
story comes line. After Dixie Carter starts to slowly fade out and Jeff Jarrett leaves the company.
Right.
That last time.
Yeah, so JR talked about it in his book. Cause he went, mm-hmm. Yeah, y'all check that out.
But you I have one more match to score. Back to AEW.
Well, we gotta go to AEW. Let's hold that for the AEW.
Let's yes. Yeah, so I want to make sure that everybody has a new schedule for Fan Club. Okay. So next week we are getting into the summer in wrestling. Everything that the crew has been into this summer, we're gonna spill all the tea, and then the following week. Which I think might be like the 13th or something. 13th. Yes. 13th. It is hashtag TNA Appreciation Night. So make note, put that on your calendars, all of that you got to do, because we are getting into that. So how about
get the thread started?
We take a break, very short break, because I may or may not have a special guest that's going to kick off AEW Appreciation Night. And we will, after that, go into Siendole Scoreboard, and we will give All Elite Wrestling all of the flowers that they deserve.
All right.
This moment, especially, it was in front of a crowd, and she came in as champion. And even though, you know, this is Bianca's moment, and, she, you know, Bianca, if Bianca didn't win, I would have been like, what the hell? It was still, I think, a moment for Sasha. For her to be self-realized, like different gear, like everything about her, the confidence, you know, of course she had to have an entrance. But this moment for me is probably one of my favorite Sasha moments. And I was trying to find a photo of Sasha's face and her and Bianca getting like emotional before the bell rings. And I think for just Black girls, Black women, shout out to Black Roslyn who got us the hoodie, the sweatshirts with the moment on it. But it was significant in so many different you know, ways. And then this being the second match that main evented WrestleMania.
But for the first Black females to do so.
Yes, exactly that.
I love reminiscing about Black women making history and wrestling. It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing. Check out our Sasha, our Mercedes Moné, FKA Sasha Banks series on YouTube. I can't wait. I'm sorry. I just cannot wait to get into our new season in a couple weeks. Like, the summer has been so busy in so many different ways. And the fact that we are officially coming back with new episodes next month is amazing. Yes, you are absolutely right, Dylan. Shout out to Black women. This podcast was powered by two Black women who were talented and driven and wanted to make sure that women like us in this industry had a voice. That is my way of plugging in my better half, the other half of those wrestling girls, Miss KRISTA B. I don't know if there's her music is prepped or not. I could bring her up, but
no, you don't hear the music.
Do you not see me vibing here? Do you not see me vibing? Because is that KRISTA B's music?
The queen is here. Hey, baby.
KRISTA.
Welcome. Can you believe that we're actually doing an AEW appreciation night?
Can you believe I'm actually honest?
We're going to try not to throw shade. It's just that, you know, me and KRISTA B are WWE heads. Like, that's just how we grew up, New York City, whatever. But we're going to give them their flowers tonight.
Okay. Very well, thank cool. you guys for having me on. Hey, Rakasha. Hey, birthday twin.
Thank you for pulling up.
Of course. You know, I could not be here for this. And I'm going to be honest. I'm shocking myself being here right now for AEW because we all know how I feel about it. Like, it was some false pretenses in the beginning, but I do appreciate the fact that AEW has given us an option to get to know wrestlers that we probably weren't watching before. that we probably weren't watching in the indies or going to indie shows in our town. So I do appreciate the fact that we have that. I appreciate the fact that we had the representation of Jade Cargill to be, I think she's the first ever Black TBS Women's Champion for a really, really long time. And she had a streak. And I love the fact that, you know, Tony Khan gave us access to her being in the Divine Nine, being in the AKA sorority. So there are a lot of things about AEW that I do appreciate. There are things, you know, that can and will get better with time. So you can't really, I'm not going to shit on them too bad because, you know, it's like me to do so, but say
it's appreciation night.
It's appreciation night, so I'm definitely going
appreciation, not depreciation.
Appreciation night. I know, as I said, it's like me to do so. I'm going to be very, very honest. It's like me to do so. However, I will definitely give credit and give roses when they are due. And AEW has opened my eyes and given me a new outlook on seeing our favorite wrestlers in different lights. And I do appreciate that, you know.
Yeah. I'm curious, Krista, because now I think AEW has been around for 5 years, I want to say, almost the same, like,
no, that's 2019,
yeah. So we are older than, TWG is a little older than AEW, so it's like, you never thought something like this would happen, but what was your, do you remember your initial reaction when they did that, like, press conference, and, because the show was great, you know, that they did, but for it that to turn into like a whole new wrestling promotion that is now regarded as the number two in the world. What was your initial reaction when you saw that this was happening?
My initial reaction was, oh shit, WWE has competition because now we're going to get all of these women that we have been struggling to see in WWE get a chance. And then it's not just women, it's women of color. Like, they are diversifying their women's division and we're going to get it and it's going to be lit. And I literally tuned in. The very first time everybody remembers is the breaking of the King's chair, of Triple H's chair, with Cody Rhodes and Brandy's just like yelling, yeah, break it, and this, that, and the third. And then, you know, Britt Baker's and Thunder Rosa's match, and Britt Baker's like a bloody mess, and I still need that on. I still need that shirt. So I was very excited to be able to see that we had wrestlers up there like Nyla Rose, we had Sunny Kiss. You know, we got to see some of our favorites, Vicky Guerrero and Arion, and all these people just jumping back and forth because they're technically free agents, and, you know, we wouldn't really get to see them in WWE like we would have liked to. And then, you know, things happened. Things changed. And now we're here. Now we're down to one women's match at All In. But, hey, at least they got shine.
Well, we can get into that scoring. Because I do have a lot to say, and apparently somebody has smoke for me. So if you don't mind, we can wrap up the scoreboard with that rating.
Okay, so let's, Krista B, I'm glad you was able to come through and talk about what you appreciate about AEW. Because it took us a little bit of time. Me and Krista B was like, we'll give it some time. But they've come a long way, still a long way to go.
Yeah.
But yeah, let's get into Siendole's scoreboard, and then we'll hear what Krista B thinks about her score of the four-way. So let's get into it.
So we're back in the scoreboard. I'm not even going to explain the criteria. You could just pull the clip up of the rating. So y'all already know what it was. This was the most anticipated women's match of the card. We had Saraya returning back to England after a year hiatus away from home. And she didn't just pull it up on, oh, honey. No, she said, I'm fighting for my family. I'm bringing you the family that is of legacy. And let's just be real. I said in the tweet, if y'all follow me on X, Twitter, whatever it's called today, y'all already know what I said. She pulled up with her brothers, her nephew, her dad, and her wrestling iconic mother to the venue. You already knew she was going to take over the venue. You already knew the match was hers. But it was a good ode to the first ever All Out. The first ever All Out did have a fatal four-way champion, but they did have a fatal four-way match. So it did pay great homage to it. She went against Shayda. She went against her other outcast member, sorry, Toni Storm. And she went against the Dr. Britt Baker, DMD. And it did not disappoint. I love the fact that Britt got to go and be where she started, back to where she's going, which is being involved in All In. I also like the fact that Saraya's family was there. I also even like the little tension that Toni and Saraya now finally show, because we've been waiting for this tension for a long time, and it's already been previewed little by little. However, I have so many qualms about how this could have made the score even higher. For one, the longevity of the match was not fair enough.
How long was the match technically? What are the numbers?
7 minutes.
The shortest match on the main card.
7 minutes. So my issue is, right, and I understand maybe time constraint, maybe they thought that they needed maybe we needed to see the whole MJF and Adam Cole breakdown for the 400th time, whether they're going to fight or beat each other's ass, or whether they're going to hug and be like stepbrothers and shit. I don't know. Maybe it was because they knew that the Will Ospreay and Chris Jericho match is going to be a little intense. But 7 minutes?
Yeah.
And then I also think about the fact that, like, Saraya's healed, but she ain't fully healed. So maybe her neck, maybe the longevity of her wrestling can't be there. Because when we went to full gear, her match at full gear was 11 minutes with Britt Baker. It was a little longer. But they didn't have that many matches on the card either. So that played in my mind, but also that really disappointed me, because it was like, it's an imbalance. Like every other match on the card, you're looking at the opening match, 15 minutes. You're looking at the second match after that with Samoa Joe and CM Punk doing whatever they were going on and doing, which was a cool 16 minutes. You look at all the balances they had on the card, and then other matches having a half hour. Love Chris Jericho to death. Did not need to see Judas live. I'm sorry. I get it. Like, it's a treat. It's cute. That took up about 4 minutes for him to walk his ass downstairs and for the match to get warmed up. It took up so much time. And then, as exciting as it was to see, like, you put that impact to have her family there, and the night going on, you overshadow it by showing Mercedes Moné in the crowd. You're jumping ahead of something that a lot of people are not thinking of. You're already, like, people already are insinuating the fact that Mercedes Moné may show up. Great. That could have been something y'all saved in the interim. Didn't need to be at All In, because y'all already jumping the gun, in my opinion.
Right.
So the match was great. Everybody put out their performance. And also, the last thing that really irked me, you don't put Shida as your traditional champion. Ever. Never. Never. Like, I don't know why they think it's okay to put Asuka and Shida as traditional champions. Don't ever do that again. Because that to me, my personal opinion, watching both ladies, y'all know, if I'm not as big as Justin is on Japan wrestling, I'm very big on those specific ladies that paid the mold to even cross over to other brands from Japan. You don't ever make her traditional champion. You could have left it on Toni. You could have left that storyline hanging. Like, I understand we're friends, we're outcasts, but I'm going home. It's my title. I'm taking it off of you. You don't make her traditional champion. She had the championship for how long?
Just a couple weeks.
Exactly. How does that make any sense? So
she wins that title August 2nd. So she doesn't. So 24 days as champion, 25 at the max before this match.
It is unfair to make her a traditional champion. I don't care what anyone thinks. I don't care what anyone. I'm like, Chris is always going to say, I'm going to feel how I feel. you don't make her a traditional champion. So that's my thoughts on that. Anybody else can jump in and think how they want to think. It could have went better so many other ways, but congratulations to Saraya. It's a big accomplishment to win in front of your friends and your family, literally in front of almost, what, 80K people, not too far away from home where you grew up. I love that for her. It just could have gone a little better. And also, it just pisses me off that there's such an imbalance on that card that you gave them 7 minutes.
This is AEW appreciation night. So okay. I'm gonna
we appreciate everything that but I don't appreciate being balanced on the card.
I'm gonna say this. I don't care as much as I hate the fact that it was 7 to 12 minutes allotted. This was still my favorite moment of the night. To see Saraya come out there to Queen. And let you know, first of all, how much money they kicked out for that.
Right.
To see it come out there, I was kind of like, oh my gosh, like, this is amazing. Like, you know, a little tear in my eye. And then for her to get that crowning moment, yeah, we can sit up there and we can beat down all the stuff. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to celebrate the fact that this woman, several years ago, was told she wasn't going to wrestle no more.
Mm-hmm.
And she would go out there and win. We ran a clip of those wrestling girls, which you can find on YouTube, doing the celebration and the spotlight on her. At that time, we wasn't sure. We heard that she was cleared, but it wasn't facts. Like, you know, in wrestling, you don't believe until you see it, right?
Right.
I'm one who trusts science, as much as that might not be popular to say, but I trust mm-hmm. science and trust medicine. I knew when Daniel Bryan got cleared and stuff, I was like, I have a feeling that Edge and Saraya are going to get cleared, and sure enough. And I just thought it was beautiful that, you know, they was able to have a match. They if you walked out, you missed out on a treat. You know, and that's when I said, Siendole, I was like looking at the scoreboard, and I understand because I do understand your criteria, but I look at it like I rated it high. It was one of my favorite moments because sometimes the matches a match can be good, but if you get that moment, it could just kind of add some spice to it. And that's what it did for me. And I understand what you're saying about Mercedes, but I mean, at the end of the day, wrestling, they compete. They could try to say it's not. One could say they not competing. They competing. If you got the Joker in your pocket, you go ahead and use it. If you know you done paid her how much the dollars to just show up, she already posted. We already know she's there. You go ahead and you show that Joker because this is going to be, in my opinion, the story we get to now. As far as Sheeta being a transitional champion, I understand exactly where you're coming from and just say this. You can kind of have this rivalry a little bit, and you can have the rivalry with the Outcast. If you want to book women's wrestling the way it should be booked, have this rivalry while you got Mercedes healing and waiting. And then when she's ready to go, put the belt back on Saraya and then let them cook and make them the main event for AEW Revolution or Double or Nothing.
Right. I was one of those people who, like, when you're watching like a pay-per-view or a PLE live, you don't really think too much about what we're talking about now in hindsight. I just knew, like, okay, we're in fucking England. Mm-hmm. Saraya is going to win this championship. Like, that was just, like, in my head. And I was just like, I need to watch this match because I know that's going to happen. And I'm a huge fan. And like you mentioned, you know, just a little while ago, it was looking like she was never going to be able to wrestle again. Here she is, the champion and the number two wrestling promotion in the world in their first international show in front of how many people? You know, he's like
1,000+ paid, as Tony Khan kept telling us during the
post. I mean, he said what, 90 at one point. So
right, exactly. And how many people? Like, that's the thing why I wanted to do an appreciation night, because as WWE fans, we've seen it. We've seen the numbers. WWE has broke countless attendance records and countless stadiums and countless events. AEW is not even 5 years old, and being able to bring this product to international fans, first of all, is amazing. But then also the wrestlers. A lot of people joke like, oh, AEW is like the super indies or whatever the case. But in that respect,
that's Eric Bischoff saying it's the super
indie wrestlers wrestled in front of almost 100,000 people live for the first fucking time. So mm-hmm. that's when you just have to kind of just appreciate that moment, appreciate that there are 80,000 fans.
I appreciate in the moment. One place. I do appreciate the moment, but my problem is how many moments we gonna appreciate before the company starts to realize, like, oh, these moments matter. Maybe we should have one more match. Maybe we could have this match on a pre-show instead of that. Like that. And again, respecting how everyone feels, y'all gonna feel how y'all feel, right? Give me more. Y'all are a 4-year company. Mm-hmm. Y'all had your first all, and I get it, wasn't enough women. Tessa Blanchard and Britt and all of them kind of came to the conclusion that we could have this match. And Tony said, well, the elite said, no, you guys are going to be on this card because you guys are the hottest you are in your scene. That was 4 years ago. Why we still got the same format from 4 years
No, Siendole, you are a 1,000% right.
And it's going to irk me, and I don't want to fight with you, Brian, but it's going to irk me that you keep saying moment. It should have been the match. It should have been the match. And I got to say, it was one of your favorite moments to me. This was one of my favorite matches on the card, besides, you know how I feel about Mason Will Ospreay, child. That I can never stop looking at that. But it was one of my favorite matches. But everybody keeps saying moment, moment, mm-hmm. moment, moment. Those all four of those women are worthy of a match. You don't give them 7 minutes to do that. It's not
You're
fair.
Right.
It's
You're
never going to be fair.
Right. And as soon as I saw the card for All In and I noticed that there were a gazillion matches and only one women's match, I absolutely had a lot to say about that for sure. But it is AEW Appreciation Night. So we are going to appreciate what we can. Dynamite just started. So we watch it as a family here in the fan club. But no, you're absolutely right. It should have been more of a moment, especially with everyone involved. I love how Nikki, Andre, everyone in the VIP comment section right now agree that maybe Saraya wasn't the right winner. There's an argument to be made about Britt. There's an argument to be made about Sheeta as a transitional champion, Toni Storm. And I think that's what made it a good match is the fact that we can make arguments that all four women should have or could have won that match. So I think that's probably the most exciting thing and why I love that we have your scoreboard because, one, you watch everything. You watch every promotion. You appreciate these women. You've been following their careers for like almost a decade now. So I love that we're able to have your perspective on these like big, big matches. And again, it's a new company. They have a lot of work to do, especially in the women's division. I want to shout out Lyric from Women's Wrestling Talk who held it down in the fucking press conference for the event this past weekend and had to deal with follow her hashtag Lyric Wrestling, follow Women's Wrestling Talk, the best women's wrestling network in the world. But it is important that people like us are talking about these things, and I'm hoping that 4 or 5 years from now when we're talking about the fifth international AEW event that we're not just talking about one out of 11 matches on the card being a women's match,
right?
You know what
that's,
I mean?
And that's what I'm hoping for because, like, in all honesty, like, that's what I'm always going to be hoping. That's why I keep scoring. It's like, listen, I said on my Twitter that I'm going to be talking about women's wrestling going forward, and I do as much, whatever it's called today. We said that. I don't know what it's called today. Tomorrow could be called ABC. It could be called the ABC app. I don't know. But I'm going to be talking about it going forward because, like, not for nothing, love the men. We've been watching the men for years. They get their shine. And shout out to Dre and Mr. Black, who I had the pleasure of watching All In with, and Heels Classic. Shout out to them. And I pointed out to them, and nobody thought about it, that nobody rates women's matches. Your homeboy Meltzer never rated a women's match at all. And you can check his archive. You can check his credentials. He's rated maybe 3 or 5 matches I can name off the top of my tongue.
I know. I don't want to hear him. Oh, go ahead.
So if there's somebody on this platform that needs to give that insight, the way that I give that insight, y'all want to throw tomatoes or bricks at me, fine, I'll be that person, but I'm going to keep speaking my piece on the Scoreboard, and I'm blessed and I'm happy that my lovely boss, Queen PR, and her co-boss, KRISTA, and the production team and the crew here have allowed me on this platform to do it. Because guess what? I'm going to keep on doing it.
And we love you for that. Period. I want to thank KRISTA too for stopping by, sharing her. She kicked off. Appreciate you tonight. Thank you for coming through, sis.
No problem. I just want to say one thing to Siendole Scoreboard, because you said you wanted to hear my opinion on it.
Yes.
and like we said, it's an appreciation night. But I just feel like the match was a good match. It was a good match given the time that they were giving, the 7 minutes that they were given. It was a great match. I just feel like for Saraya, knowing where her neck injury is compared to what Daniel Bryan's was, compared to what Edge's was, compared to whoever had neck injuries previously, Nikki Bella's was, you know, Garcia, ooh, whoever was. It's like when I see Saraya fight, and she hasn't been in the ring much since she came back to AEW. Right. Every time she has been there, it's like she's doing it scared.
Yeah. That I noticed too.
It's like she's not giving her all. And I feel like Siendole, you gave it a 4.4. I feel like if she would have just went out there knowing that she is definitely loved and appreciated and went back into that bag and prayed to God, like, hey, cover me real quick while I'm out here, and gave more of herself into that match, I'm pretty sure you would have rated it more than a 4.4. I feel like with this 7-minute match, she's kind of reverting back to where it was in Diva's era, fighting for more time. And because of it being so short, it kind of took away from the fact that she's back home in her own backyard, in her own playground, with her family, literally fighting for the biggest honor in AEW promotion for the women's division. And that was kind of like sidestepped and sidetracked by the 7 minutes that they had. So it seems like it was kind of rushed. It seemed like, you know, it wasn't getting enough because you had to get through all of these matches. You had 2 tag team matches, I believe. Yeah, I can correct me if I'm wrong. Then you had John Moxley bleeding with skewers coming out of his
Child, I don't even want to get into that. I went to the bathroom.
But what I'm saying is, I was actually driving home during that time. I was like, you know. But what I'm saying is, it kind of just took away from that special moment to know, like, we as fans didn't get to relish in it with her as she was in that moment.
Right.
Because of the time, because of how many, like, I was really confused. Like, I didn't know it was supposed to be a fatal four way. I thought it was literally Saraya versus Sheeta for the belt. I didn't know Toni Storm was in it. I didn't know that Britt Baker was supposed to be in it. I don't know what happened with Toni Storm and Saraya's mother until Siendole said something. I didn't know any of what was going on. But that moment where we were supposed to appreciate it more for Saraya, it just kind of got, like, swept.
That's what I did. I appreciate it. And I wanted to see a longer match. I mean, but I don't need all the men's matches to be 25 minutes apiece. Exactly. I mean, the Jericho match could have been cut in half because Chris Jericho ain't got the juice no more.
Need to see some, like I'm still CM Punk fan, still here. Did not need to see him for 17 minutes. And did not need to see Samoa Joe sidestep him for 50.
I get it.
FTW match literally could have been on All Out. Just saying.
It was just a lot going on. And for, like I said, like
shout out to you, Dylan, baby, all the way from across the water, honey. I know you got my back.
Man,
baby.
It's like I fight kangaroos. You think I won't hop my ass over here and go throw hands?
I love you, Dylan.
That's funny. But back to my point before I get off of this, it's just like, what I said earlier, I was excited for when AEW first came on because they promoted all of these women. They had us enticed with, oh my gosh, you know, it's the diversity. You have transgender wrestlers. You have homosexual wrestlers. You have wrestlers who were, you know, non-binary or whatever. Like, you have all this inclusion, black, white, Asian, Hispanic. You had all of these diverse female wrestlers that you put into the forefront. He said he lived with koalas too. that you put into the forefront, and then you go from that hype,
yeah,
and all of that to a 7-minute match at one of at what we can say is your WrestleMania for the women, and one of your biggest stars' hometown, and we had to like literally, yay, you're home. Watch match, blink, it's over.
Yeah, that's my little frustration.
Two finger congratulations to Saraya. All right, get off. So we got it because we got to get the main event.
Yeah, and that's what I'm glad you get it. I think that's where it boils down to me the most, because it was like the much y'all could have did, even like, and y'all know how to play it. Y'all could have kept Saraya out of the match for a little bit and let the longevity go. But it was just like y'all like, all right, we want to give Saraya this in her hometown, y'all make it quick and make it look cute so we can move on. Like, that's what it felt like to me, and it bothers me. Like, do better. Like, and we're gonna get into it a little bit more as we go into the appreciation, because I want to give my flowers to Brandi Rhodes, because it feels like when Brandi Rhodes, like, it wouldn't be this way for the diversity it had when it first started. Even Jay credits her full career to people like Cody and Brandi, because Brandi was very involved. Like, I joined the heels thing, first of all, I'm gonna get into that, because it was that, and that's what made me excited about AEW, because they didn't care. Like, they made their first women's champion a transgender woman. That's huge. So that you go off huge. Of that to this, I don't want to bash a brand, but
no, we're not that's bashing a brand. It's appreciation night. But I want to get into, I want to take a break, and then I want to get into some of those moments, because there have been a lot of groundbreaking moments in AEW. The fact that they were able to make it to be the number two wrestling promotion in the fucking world.
Right.
Let's give some love to KRISTA B. Thank you.
Love you, boo.
Us, babe. I love you so much. I love everything you have cooking.
Heffa and Black Bitch. That's it.
No, okay, we
good.
Those words are in the box. Yep. I can't do that.
Great. Yeah. Good. I'm gonna go check out our future venue spot. I'll see you guys later.
Love you.
Love you.
Let's take a break and we'll be right back.
Hey, what's up, y'all? It's your girl, KRISTA B, one half of those wrestling girls, and we hope that you're enjoying this current episode that we have for you. You know, I had to come in here, interject, and plug ourselves real quick. We want to tell you about our merch exclusively on foryourwear.com. That's right. For Your Wear has all of those wrestling girls merch that you want and need, not only for yourself, but for your friends, your family, and your loved ones. We have t-shirts, we have hoodies, we have tank tops. So please go over to foryourwear.com to make sure you get those exclusive merch, those exclusive deals, and tell them that TWG sent you.
This reminds me of vintage TWG, especially getting into our 5th anniversary event.
Same Michael Cole, I hear you, Michael November Cole. 4th. Vintage TWG. You imagine like Michael Cole on the call, him and Pat McAfee.
I don't like football. You need like a Pat McAfee type entrance.
Yeah, I don't like football no more. Just because they took it took Pat.
That's
Pat
a lie. Away.
What? He goes back.
I mean, the way my Orioles are playing right now, I can live without football for, you know, probably through November.
Well, that's your problem there. So a couple months.
Mm-hmm.
That's your problem. Look at who you're rooting for.
Huh?
I said, look at who you're rooting for. That's your
issue. The first place Baltimore Orioles.
See, end of the game. It's been a while. Let him have this. This is now Oreo appreciation night for 1 minute. So we're gonna let you have this.
No,
not even a minute.
And last time I seen him in New York, victorious over the Yankees. I'm just
Brian. Don't make us turn this appreciation into depreciation. Let's not pull up receipts. We're gonna let you have this.
I appreciate that, Black Thoughts. Our anniversary event is November 4th.
And shout out to him. He was at the viewing party too. So good to see him.
It's always really, really good to see him. So let's get into hashtag AEW appreciation night. I do want to remind everyone, I don't know if it's lost in translation, this is appreciation night. of AEW. We are not talking about what we don't like about the promotion. I just want to put that out there. We are appreciating All Elite Wrestling tonight as a promotion outside of the event that just happened last weekend. We are talking about it as a whole, as a company, as a wrestling company, and what it has brought to the wrestling world and as fans. So you mentioned Brandi Rhodes, Siendole, and the reason why I want to start there is because I don't always give her her just due and props because of cringy promos, but her and Cody Rhodes were like right there starting this promotion, like in that press conference. So why did you feel like we needed to give Brandi her flowers to start off?
Because when she, it, like, you don't get a lot of women, of course, coming from where the both the company they came from, they both came from WWE. They met in WWE. They obviously were also around two of the most influential parts of the authority of running a company there was to look at, being Triple H and Stephanie McMahon. I felt like when she finally started doing matches and started being by her husband's side a lot more and started being more of an authoritative figure and just being more less than a valet and more of like a we are team. I'm not just the valet. I'm not just his wife. I am the A to his B. Like, it got better. You started seeing, like, for example, you brought up Sunny Kiss. It was not put out there as much, but Sunny Kiss, like, she's just amazing, in my opinion. That was my first exposure to her. It was my first exposure to, when Nyla Rose came on, it was so different. And I feel like the impact of seeing these different type of women that you don't see in WWE wouldn't have happened if it wasn't for her, because she pushed for heels when it was created. She pushed for it, and she pushed for it hard. Like, it wasn't just like, oh, this is about women's wrestling. No, all these women were giving you their backstory. I remember when Jade was talking about being the best at everything and being strong, but not seeing, like, being strong enough on this level is different. You know, I remember Sunny Kiss talking about how she wasn't really accepted in the indie circuit, but when she finally got to AEW, she was accepted. You talk about Nyla Rose, where she's not seen in a box. She can compete and do anywhere, anytime. And it's because of that program. Like, even Vicky Guerrero, somebody that we thought was out of the wrestling business for good, now you see her in AEW doing so much of the work, putting in her expertise to learn. And I feel like without Brandi, that motivation, if you hear the stories of people talking about Brandi Rhodes, she was a big inspiration backstage. Because, of course, you know that Cody and the Elite and Kenny and other people that were first involved were all dealing with the men. They knew what men they wanted there. But how do you get to draw everybody else? You need a woman force. And I feel like with Brandi and Vicky, they were definitely the two that just started pulling people up. Like, remember, Ariane went there for a while. You started seeing, there's a lot of people in WWE. Like, I remember Cora Jade was on an episode of Dark a long time before she got signed to WWE. Same thing with Gigi Dolin before she got signed to WWE. A lot of these indie talents, like, the program for Dark started with the women, and you saw a lot of new faces, like Trish Adora during the pandemic era was on that programming.
100%.
So it just, without her impact, I feel like, and I understand if it's not as impactful, but heels still exists. I still be getting them emails. They still do the meet and greets. They still do everything they try and do.
I wondered about that.
They still do it all. They still do it all. But it wouldn't be that way without Brandi.
Right. I'm glad you brought up the women mostly, because I think what was the most refreshing thing about the announcement of AEW and that press conference they did was there was sort of a, I don't want to say a promise, but there was something said that they would do more for women's wrestling. So that's what a lot of people were excited about. Brandi Rhodes founded the company as an executive. So we are coming from Stephanie McMahon pretty much being the most important woman in wrestling for fucking years, and even probably still is to this day. So seeing Brandi Rhodes come into that role, you know, supporting her husband and, you know, crafting her own lane after just being a ring announcer in WWE, that's huge. Mm-hmm. And I have even more of a respect for it after watching the Cody Rhodes documentary, because behind every strong man, there's a strong ass woman. And Brandi Rhodes is right there doing everything that she could to help Cody achieve his dreams after he left WWE, including founding AEW. Shout out to Get Your Podcast. What's your favorite AEW moment so far since its inception? But It did. I'm glad you mentioned Dark. It did give a lot of opportunity for women that either hadn't made it to WWE yet, who were grinding on the indies, who didn't quite make it in that company, but found their niche in AEW, including Brady Rose as a performer and a wrestler. And also to newbies like the Jade Cargills of the world, who, you know, they just, that's a homegrown talent. The fact that we can look at amazing Marvel like Jade Cargill and say that she's an AEW homegrown talent is huge, and that's not lost on me. So I do also want to appreciate that, giving a platform to people like Saraya, who was told, you know, in her best interest, you know, by other companies that she can't wrestle again. We just watched her win the title in her hometown in front of 80,000 people. So I do love that women are given sort of like a second chance. In AEW, and it was very exciting to see that they were going to do that. So I love that Brandi was able to do what she was able to do there. Heels was very controversial when it came out. AEW Heels, it was a subscription service
for women,
women fans, and also to showcase the women talent in AEW. I don't know how well it was particularly executed or marketed, but I love to hear that it's still happening. So there were efforts made for women in wrestling in general. So that's why, you know, Krista B and I were excited when we first heard about AEW for sure. What are some other things that we can appreciate about the company that decided to fucking wage war? They said, we're going to go live on Wednesday night. We're going to just go up in there. But just kind of thinking of the beginning stages of AEW, what are some of the things that you, did any of you go to their first show? Like, I want to hear some of those initial thoughts on it.
I was at the first show in DC. And, you know, when you walked in there, like, I've been to numerous indie shows, none. But so I didn't get that feel like, oh, this is another independent wrestling. It felt like what I missed out on. Like, I never got a chance to go to a WCW show, and I was like, okay, you know, the setup was nice, it was decent. The way it looked really good, you know. I couldn't wait to go back and watch it on TV to see how the presentation looked, and it was like, wow, like, you know, even look better. And this is no shade at TNA or Impact, but it just looked different. You could tell that they had did some like WWE recruiting, right? So I used to work at ESPN, right? I started September 2013. If y'all remember, Fox Sports 1 started really around June, July 2013. And when I got there, the one thing I was told was that they had poached a lot of people from ESPN. And, you know, it was like, why would you live in Bristol if you can live in LA and make more money? You know, you're working for a newer company. And you saw, like, when you turned on Fox Sports 1, you was like, man, this kind of looks like ESPN, but just an alternative, as they show in Paige on right now. So when I watched AEW, it was like the same thing. So that was one of the things I appreciated. You know, Cody Rhodes versus Sammy Guevara, the very first match on that very first Dynamite. You know, one of the things I did appreciate was with Cody, when he came out there, he wasn't going to try to put himself over as much as I wanted to see him win the world title. Because when Cody left WWE, when he was leaving, I was like, all right, whatever. But when I saw him hit the indies and had that resurgence, that rebirth, and really fall in love with professional wrestling again, he was somebody I became a fan of. So I didn't like that stipulation that he put himself in. But obviously now we know he wants to finish the story. So I really enjoyed it. And you know, just from the beginning, I said it's something, and I will always say this, it's very, very enjoyable when you watch it in person. You know, the four of us was that all full gear last year, and it's a show that you will really enjoy when you watch it in person. And you can start to see now, and I'll finish this off. When you talk about just like what you appreciate, you can see now, like, they've learned from their mistakes production wise, and it looks better. Collision and Dynamite look like two different shows. That was my biggest thing, but Collision and Dynamite look like two different shows, and that's what I like.
Agreed. I can't also help but think about other women that kind of were given opportunities that they felt like they hit a ceiling. And one of those is Renee Paquette. She was in WWE and she was a very prominent face. Like, it was very weird to see her not. Oh, and Nikki, we are going to get into how AEW is better as a in person later on, because that's my thing I appreciate. But somebody like Renee Paquette, she was like, I hit my ceiling in WWE. I did all that I can do. I was a part of so many different things. But now she has a whole new lease in life at AEW. The same with Moxley. The same with everyone. Like, the thing with the other company is that it's not for everyone. Not everyone is built for that system. Like, Punk is in denial about how much of a WWE guy he is. I'm going to just say that. But not everyone can acclimate.
Ahead. No disagreement for me on that one. I'm just let that one go.
Right. So then you have people that go to AEW and they fucking thrive, including a lot of the people that we mentioned before. And I love that people have more opportunity there, like 1,000%. But I want to stick on this women's division topic really quickly before we move on, because I know we talk about it a lot. But we need to put more emphasis on the fact that Tony Khan, All Elite Wrestling, was willing to put the World Women's Championship title on a trans woman. That is fucking huge, and something that I would have never thought would happen. Like, I am the most accepting person in the world, and I knew that would never happen in WWE. But the fact that AEW took a stand and said, no, this is who we're going to put our title on. Shout out to Nyla Rose. Like, how did you guys feel about that?
Well, I'm biased. You know, what they say, 5-6 degrees of separation. One of my best friends is best friends with Nyla Rose. So, and when I got a chance to, like, you know, meet her, Nyla, you really see, you know, just how much of an incredible person she is. Aww. But also see how she's, like, willing to help anybody in wrestling. So that made me even happier. Like, she was helping the person who was, like, conducting this, like, interview, who was on the indies, and she was like, look, just like I tell the referees, you're in control. You take charge of the interview. She said she tells the referees, no matter if it's me in there or Stone Cold Steve Austin, you control the match. So when you have somebody like that willing to give back to the business and help each and everybody understand everybody has their part, you know, it makes you root for them even more. But I thought it was a phenomenal, you know, because it's like, okay, you're making it known that and Wolf Warrior says never needed a manager. And I can understand where you're coming from, but it's like Vicky Guerrero, like Vicky's like one of the best.
Right.
If people don't give Vicky enough credit, like there was at one point Vicky got the most heat in WWE, the biggest company. Like, I've been to shows where you at the concession stands and you hear the crowd booing Vicky Guerrero. So it's like, you know, CM Punk might not need a manager, but are you really gonna say don't give him Paul Heyman? That's how I feel like, you know, when it comes to Vicky Guerrero. But overall, Nyla Rose, just an incredible, and it showed, you know, progress, you know. So I thought that was great, especially because they automatically, like, it's like a cheat card, right? Because of the money they had. I always said this: if there was ever to be competition for WWE, the one thing they was going to need was somebody who loved wrestling and that was willing to lose money. I was saying this in 2016, 2017, and that's exactly what happened. You had Tony Khan, who was rich enough to take that L. And because he had that cheat code, it was a lot of things that, like, no offense, Impact Wrestling could do it, but nobody would, it's like not that many people would have knew about it. AEW had the clout immediately. They had the ability to, you know, put the press availability to do it. So I thought that was great.
So what are some other things that we appreciate about AEW before we get into the live shows? Because that is what I'm most excited about. We put the tweet out there. So I think it's time for us to go into some of those
comments. The Xbox.
So Backstage Brawl, shout out to them. They are family. They said that they appreciate the fact that AEW are one of the best secondary promotions in North America. There, your homegrown stars have the potential to be huge when they are given the shot. They have a bit of everything you love about pro wrestling. I have to agree.
I agree
with that, and I can't help but think about like MJF or Orange Cassidy, you know, talents or kind of personas. I don't know if the other promotions would have known what to do with, but I think this is the instance where Tony Khan gives their talent enough leeway to do what they got to do. But how do you feel about Backstage Brawl's comments, Justin?
I agree. And the best thing about AEW is they push WWE to be better directly and indirectly because of the fact that AEW gives you the alternative to what WWE cannot give you. Like, WWE is basically, we are PG, we are a publicly traded company, we are a billion-dollar corporation, we got to think about kids and families and sponsorships and stuff like that, so we can't do death matches. We can't do certain style of matches to where our talent could get injured or our talent could get seriously injured to where they're on the shelf, whereas AEW offers the alternative of, like, we can put on banger of matches to where WWE can't match that. We can give you a style of wrestling WWE can't match. We can actually push the people that WWE don't see as your top champions, your top of the cards, or even like your cards. That's where you see people like MGF get your chance. You see people like Darby Allin have a spot on the card. You see someone like Jungle Boy Jack Perry, who they are invested in, and so on and so forth. And indirectly, again, that makes it, like P said earlier, like WWE, Vince thrives on competition, and sometimes Vince has to be dragged kicking and screaming into change. Like, you had to look at that women's division. He didn't want to change that overnight. It took Ronda Rousey. It took Serena Williams. It took Stephanie McMahon. It took Give Divas a Chance. It took its entire women's locker room. It took the women of NXT, and it took the fans bitching and moaning ad nauseum, change this shit. We're tired of 5-minute matches, and you treating the women like bathroom breaks for them to change and finally see them as equals. And I know AEW will get there. I know we've been, you know, tonight and through this week, we've been giving AEW a lot of shit about their women's division, but they have made progress. You know, Shida and Toni Storm did main event for that AEW women's title 3 weeks ago, which is how Shida won the title in the first place. That's only the second time you've had women main event in an AEW show. It's progress compared to other places and stuff like that. So, and then with the homegrown stars, you just see it where, yes, you see your WWE talents that are blossoming better in AEW, but you see, like, they're mixing in their homegrown stars too. You see, like, all right, so Rhea's got the title, but you see them also push Jamie Hayter. You see them also push Chris Statlander. Jay Cargill was your longest, was it, TBS champion for a minute before she lost that title. So you get balance over there too. And if AEW doesn't exist, I don't think you see a lot of the growth and change in WWE these last couple of years either.
That's a good point.
That is such a good point. Can we get into production? Because I'm always one that's going to say no one's going to ever match the E's production level. Like, they just are TV production and got in the bag. But I got to say, the entryway and all of that for All In this past weekend was amazing. The evolution of the entrances and all of that has been amazing. How do you guys feel about the production of AEW and the fact that it's on TV just as much as WWE is?
You know, like, it was reported that one of the people who was there was former WWE people, a couple of the people. You know, obviously, I think they said the guy who was there is was going to be, like, they was thinking as Kevin Dunn's successor. So, you know, you remember we was here right here on the fan club when they debuted the new set. And it was just like, wow, you know. So I like that. And you know, we did talk about the camera angles and sometimes they can be unpleasant, but you know, you do get, they know how to, like, put together those vignettes and you know, like wrestling, like ever since we was little watching wrestling, it was the vignettes that would get us, hooked, that would have us asking, can we order the pay-per-views? If you know, and that's one thing they do well at is when they do the vignettes or when you have the sit down conversations that Jim Ross is doing, like, and then Kenny Omega gets up and gets beat up and Jim Ross gets up, walk away like that ain't got nothing to do with me. So, you know, I give him a lot of credit with that because I'm a production nerd. So I like looking at that stuff and I'm like, oh, man, you know, what kind of cameras they use it. And then you even see some of that stuff translate on the social media. And you know, even with the reality show that they did, which is incredible, you get to see a lot of the stuff behind the scenes. You see like them sitting there. And I thought they did a phenomenal job during the pandemic as well, because that was a time that wasn't easy to do, but I thought they made it work.
Yeah, when you look at the backstage stuff, I think that's what kind of made me try and understand everything was going on now with All Access. I actually really enjoyed All Access because it finally gave in depth. And some people were saying it was a little too early, but I think it did what it was supposed to do for AEW, which is we want to know how this company is on such this high rise to be another company to rival a company. We always know the production was going on with WWE, because even if you haven't been backstage, you're still getting a glimpse of the ins and outs with Total Divas and with Breaking Ground and with all the shows they already had. But it was different to see how this secondary company was pulling off everything they pulled off. Even like, for example, we could talk about the Sammy Guevara situation that they were showing on the show. He was having his frustrations about being backstage, and even he was like able to walk up to Tony. I think that's what people start to even get a better glimpse at Tony, if you will. You're able to walk up to Tony and be like, hey man, like I have this reservation about not being on a card. Like, and like, and mind you, this is a president owner of the company, like, but you're able to literally walk up to him, which people have that longevity of you never walk up on your boss and just be like, hey, what's up? But the wrestlers are able to literally walk up to him and be like, hey, like, I'm not on next week's card. Like, and I had this moment last week, like, what's going on? And he's able to be open with his people. That's why, and people can say how they want about him wrestling the company, like how he's running the company, that's actually not a bad trait to have as a owner of a company or somebody who works in production, because you want to be able to clue your people in on what's going on. Like, that's why people are no matter what frustrations are going, you see they're still sticking with AEW, and I think that's part of the reason why. So even with watching All Access, it gave me a better insight on everything that was going on, because like you said, you see the stuff that's going on, like for example with the Ruby Soho and Taya Conti spot. Homegirl had her nose broken, and people were wondering, like, is it kayfabe? Was it an accident? Was it real? Was it set up for something else? And then you watch the show, and you're like, oh, shit. Like, no, that was an actual accident. But Ruby felt her way, and Ty Conti feel this type of guilt about, you know, listen, I broke your nose, but, like, we're professional wrestlers. But Ruby's like, if you do that crap again, I'm going to have you. Like, that's the type of – it was kind of interaction that was, like, you always wondered if it happened, but that show exposed it. But to me, it was like the regular mills of like a regular company. Like it's like the undercover boss for that company. I enjoyed it. It made me look at the brand in a completely different perspective. Like it's not as easy as people think it is to run that company.
No,
Mike Booble.
You are muted, friend.
You're muted, Booble.
Oh, I'm sorry. My Alexa was going ham. But I'm glad that you brought that up, Siendole, too, because you mentioned two things that I want to talk about, and it was the fact that they had a reality show on television, too. Rose to the Top.
Oh, yeah. Love Rose to the Top.
And All Access. So we were able to get a lot of that insight that we probably was never able to get. Also, a feat that, like, you wouldn't think a new promotion would be able to get. So I love that.
But and it's on HBO Max on top of that. I like that.
Ooh,
like
Warner HBO Brothers, Max?
It's on HBO. That's how I was able to watch
Big
it.
Dogs.
That's how I was able to watch it. I can remember because we were always doing fan club and I was tired and then Wrestling Run was on. It was like this whole, I'm like, listen, it's one or the other. So when it came on, when the deal came up, every Warner Brothers show, every TBS show is now on HBO Max and AEW All Access is now there. So hopefully they get a season two. Because it is a really good concept.
It really is a good concept, too. But you also mentioned Tony Khan. Mm-hmm. And he gets mocked a lot on my channels as well for what he's doing. But again, we did give him his flowers for, you know, founding a company that's able to do what it's doing. Mm-hmm. But what do we appreciate him as an owner and booker and president of the company as opposed to like others? He's, you know, he's very visible. He's very outspoken. He's very blunt.
Very passionate.
Passionate. Exactly. So what are some of the things you guys appreciate about Tony Khan running the show?
That he's not listening to people. That. And that he's he's listening to himself 50 versus listening to people that are behind him. And you could tell, like, that whole Ring of Honor decision, it couldn't have been easy. Like Brian said, Brian, it was one of the best decisions made. Mm-hmm. He didn't leave a company that had legacy out in limbo. But I know for a fact there were people that are back there that are like, listen, you can help this company. And it's clear because look at who's former Ring of Honor there versus who's with him in AEW now.
Yeah, we get to see people like, you know, Caprice Coleman, you know, doing like commentary, you know, getting Kevin Kelly. And just like you said, that legacy that they have, that history, like, no offense, WWE buys it. It goes on the shelf. They're gonna use all the footage and all that stuff. And that would have been cool. Sure, it would have been cool to see Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens, and you got the whole library, the whole history. But to be able to see other people get a chance, I mean, we talked about Athena, you know, mm-hmm. Athena is their world champion, and being able to see her and Willow put on phenomenal matches. So that's the one thing I'm gonna give him credit for. Is that, and the fact is, and another thing is the fact that him being, you know, part owner and whatever his position is with the Jacksonville Jaguars and NFL team, this positions wrestling and football in a different state, you know, right. So that's another thing.
I also want to point out, like, he didn't just like, okay, I bought this company, so now we're starting over from scratch. If you guys notice, even when Ring of Honor was being bought out, they mm-hmm. tied up a lot of loose ends. And whoever wanted to stay, stayed. And whoever went. But then it was a steady communication of, okay, this was Ring of Honor, then this is Ring of Honor now. Where can we put you? And shout out to Shane Taylor. I'm so happy he's still there because he's one of the OGs that was left before the transition. And he's still holding it down. And it's a lot of people that also, though, he's giving people chances. Like I know Cheeseburger is one of the most hype people to come out of before Ring of Honor. He was the most hype person on any circuit, and now he's at almost every single Ring of Honor tape, and they love him some Cheeseburger. Even with Dalton Colton, same thing. With Sky Blue getting her chance to go to Ring of Honor, with Athena now being a champion, with Mercedes Martinez being able to go back and still do her thing in Ring of Honor. A lot of people are getting chances in Ring of Honor. So, yes, it did take away from what Dark and Elevation were doing, but we're glad we have Ring of Honor because Ring of Honor still has that it still has that credibility and it still has that respect mm-hmm. in the industry. So where it's like, all right, if I go to Ring of Honor before I go to AEW, I'm here. Like Willow Nightingale was doing a couple of tapings before that. And Elevation.
It catapulted above Impact. Yeah.
It did.
You know, because Impact was number two, then Ring of Honor. And even, you know, then it was AEW, Impact, Ring of Honor. Now it's like, nah, it's WWE, AEW, Ring of Honor, then Impact.
Yeah. And then you have, with having Claudio go back there and become their champion for a while, you know, they brought part of the Umpire Club to be the tag team champions, which gives it international notability now. Because the United Empire is like one of the most high anticipated like tag teams across the water, and they're able to do it on Ring of Honor on American TV. So it does what it's supposed to do transition wise, and that's what I'm looking at it from that point of view, because you need that. Like we talk about NXT day in, day out, we're starting to fall in love with NXT, but people are also starting to fall in love with Ring of Honor again, and I'm happy mm-hmm. to see that. The same reason.
The thing that I love about Tony Khan is that he makes himself available and visible to where even when we shit on him about the different things in the company, he's able to, you know, we're able to hold his feet to the fire, but he's able to sit there and take accountability and talk about it in a way that Vince never does. You're never going to see Vince McMahon doing any of these pressers or these press conferences.
Right.
Vince stays insulated. Vince has his own crew of people that's like, you're going to jump out in the middle of fire. The only time you're going to see me is if you absolutely need to see me.
Oh, yeah.
Like when he had all those allegations and stuff like that. But Tony makes himself available to where, like, you know, we can ask him directly about, yo, the state of the women's division and this and that. And I know he takes a lot of shit for the state of the women's division, but it's not all entirely his fault either. You got to look at it mm-hmm. like this. Like, you've had a lot of injuries in that women's division, whether it's Thunder Rosa having to drop the title for an unnamed injury, whether it's Chris Statlander who tore ACL, whether it's Jamie Hayter who's on the shelf right now. Even Soraya had to work herself back because she hadn't wrestled in so long. You have injuries that pile up. On top of, sometimes you got to hold these fucking fickle fans accountable. You guys want women's wrestling, then you also got to support it too. You got to sit there, cheer them on, talk about it on social media, and give that energy instead of using that for a fucking bathroom break or a concession stand run or a merch run. Oh, Jade's wrestling? Okay, now's a good time to go to the bathroom. Like, nah, if you really care about women's wrestling, then actually support it and show it and talk about it and be visible versus like, well, I want women's wrestling, but not that.
Right.
Then speak up, like, what do you want? Because there's only so much Tony can do. And Tony does listen versus Vince. You kind of have to force him to change. Whereas Tony's actually listening and paying attention.
That's true. There is a big difference. And I do believe there is a balance. Like, I feel like Vince is like one extreme and Tony Khan might be like the other extreme. And then you got Eric Bischoff somewhere in there too. So it is nice to kind of see how those two different extremes run wrestling companies like in the modern era. And I think in hindsight, we're going to look back at this time and be like, wow, this is like fucking fascinating that we're able to see this come up. So I have a question for the crew as well as all our VIP in the comments. Who is AEW's best homegrown talent and why?
When you say homegrown talent,
I mean, like, how
define homegrown, because I remember,
okay, so
there's a lot of indie.
Homegrown, I mean, obviously everyone comes from the indies to some extent, but who did AEW elevate into a household name, to someone that we now pay attention to, where if you don't watch wrestling, you may or may not recognize their names?
Darby Allin.
I mean, there's only one guy that comes to mind. Oh, go ahead, Siendole. I'll let you go first.
Darby Allin. Because male side, Darby Allin, you can throw, I want to put this properly, you can, Darby Allin, no matter how you slice it and dice it, he is the Mick Foley for that brand. And let me tell you why. You can throw Mick Foley into anything, and Mick Foley will find a way to make it work. Anything. Darby Allin has literally been put in front of your favorite. He's been put of everyone, new, old, legendary, iconic. He's been partnered with Sting for a reason. It's because he's seen as somebody, like a pillar-wise, he's literally seen as somebody who you will talk about even when he's like, all right, I'm going to take this break. I'm going to be gone for a year. You're going to be wondering what's Darby Allin going to be doing and when is he coming back? He's somebody that always piques somebody's interest, and which is why a lot of people were confused about the Strickland, him being in that Strickland match with Sting. Y'all would have been pissed. And I say this, I know full intent, people would have been pissed if Darby Allin was not on that card. So I understand. But Darby Allin is somebody who you're going to stick to a wall, and you know whatever you stick him on the wall, he's going to stick no matter what. And mind you, you look at his record, he's had stipulation match after stipulation match after match with an icon, match with CM Punk. He went up against Jericho. He went up against, he's gone up against so many people that you almost like, are we running out of people for Darby Allin? Like, you get to a point with a wrestler, like with Mick Foley, I used to always wonder as a kid, like, damn, is there anybody that Mick Foley ain't put a thumbtack on the back of? Like, when he fought Randy Orton, like, that's how I feel about Darby Allin. Like, there's no, like, do we have enough people for Darby Allin? Like, do we? Like, but, and I like that. I like that because you know for a fact he's always going to put on a show. He's different. Like, he's different. He's what you need. He's the alternative that you need, but you know he's going to stick. And that's why people love Mick Foley. And that's why I think I've grown to him as being a homegrown talent.
Good luck.
Stop it. Be nice.
Appreciation night. Appreciation.
I'm not discrediting. I just don't agree with her, but that's all.
Okay. Well, you this don't agree with a lot of things. It's okay. You're going to feel your way. I'm going to feel my way. There we go.
This was an overwhelming choice on our Twitter page and in the comments amongst our VIPs is Jade Cargill. I mean, she was she's an anomaly. Let's talk about her really quick, and then we'll get into some of the.
You said it in your criteria. Right there, that's the answer. Everything you said in your criteria is Jade Cargill. Mm. When you sit back and think about who else is on the Breakfast Club, who's crossing over, that's a homegrown talent. Who are you putting on TNT at night? You're not putting Darby Allin on the show with Sir Charles and Kenny
Smith. You're putting him on a paper because you're putting him on a pay-per-view.
No, we're talking crossover. We're talking money makers. We saying who's visible, who's going to be in the stores, who's going to be somebody
that's Darby Allin's be in the stores too, baby.
I'm not putting him on Good Morning America.
That's your opinion.
I'm trying to make money. What I'm saying, her criteria, it's Jade Cargill. Because when you look at her, she meets the airport test.
Not disagreeing with you on that, but we asked who's one of their best homegrown talents. We're talking about best. We're talking about people that have sprouted from the ground up. We get it. I love me some Jade Cargill. I love looking forward to whatever red carpet she's going to walk against. I get it. But as far as people who you can say built the house, the foundation that AEW sits on, that's what I think when I think homegrown talent. That's what I think of. The people that built the house that the foundation sits on. Because if they didn't have that, you would just have the elite and Kenny Omega still wrestling random people they used to wrestle with in the indie circuit. But now they're fighting with people who they brought over and made them better and made them relevant to AEW. So that's
Stan Stasiak built the house, the WWF, but nobody talk about him. They talk about Bruno San Martino.
They don't respect him enough.
I'm just saying. But in all seriousness, like, everything, you know, Jade Cargill, you look at everything she's done, and you know, as we get into, you know, just showing appreciation for her, it's a reason she was on that reality show with Brandy and you know, with a Rose to the Top. She's a needle mover, she's everything, like Bow Wow, right? You talk about that in that whole situation. You was paying attention if you wasn't a wrestling fan, because no matter how you may feel about Bow Wow, Lil Bow Wow, or Shad Moss, when he does something, whether he's trolling on the internet or, you know, you're going to pay attention because he was a child prodigy. He was one time an easily top 10 superstar rapper at one point. So that's what Jade Cargill is. And so you're like, wait a minute. Bow Wow paying attention? Does he want to become a wrestler? Why is he getting involved with who is? Whoa, okay.
Can I interrupt really quickly? Because I feel like that's another thing that I also appreciate about AEW is, like, other companies are very strategic with whatever celebrities they bring into the fold, like almost too much so. Mm-hmm. But AEW, we have Rick Ross, we have fucking Snoop Dogg actually wrestling, doing fucking frog splashes and shit. We had so many Trina. Like, I'm sorry,
they would not have any other celebrities. The key word being relevant, unlike WWE, who likes to unearth Kid Rock for every 5 years for like Detroit shows. I don't know why, because Kid Rock hasn't been relevant since fucking Bow with the Bob. But AEW, Rick Ross is relevant, Trina is relevant, Fabulous is relevant, West Side Gun relevant, Snoop relevant, Bow Wow, say what you want. Like Brian said, mention Bow Wow's name, people fucking talk about him. Action Bronson, relevant.
My thing is, okay, you just mentioned all these people. They aren't the only people. Jade Cargill didn't deal with all these people. And my thing is, for you to be a homegrown talent doesn't mean you show up on every radio station or every TV program or every red carpet. Again, homegrown talent and household name are two totally different things. And I feel like Jade Cargill is both. However, we're talking about homegrown talent. Again, if you're using homegrown talent as a term, and I know you know this, Mr. Hollywood Waters, means that these are people that are going to be on the president's wall of the AEW White House, even if they were to leave. So yes, Jade falls into that category, but so does Darby Allin. So does Ricky. Damn sure Ricky Starks. Because there are people that go to these shows to see him. They go to Collision to see and I'm biting my own tongue here. They go to Collision to see Ricky Starks. I'm sorry. Like, the overwhelming demand that he had in Newark, like, nobody was sitting their ass down. Like, the Acclaimed, they're household names to me also, because look at what they were able to build with a gimmick that didn't even exist when they first got there. Like, red carpets are cute, cool, you know, radio shows are cool, but, like, you want somebody who's going to forever be on the wall. Like, The Rock goes and he does all this stuff. Guess where his picture is still sitting? I get it, in WWE, but there are also other people that are in WWE that have the same effect, not just because they're all doing red carpets and all this stuff. I just look at the term homegrown talent differently. That's it.
I mean, somebody, if we're going to use how you look at homegrown talent, then the name that I have yet to hear either one of you guys mention, who honestly should be jumping off the fucking screen because he just main evented fucking All In. How are we not talking about MJF?
I was going to get there.
How are we not talking about Maslow, Jacob Freeman, and the fact that we watched him grind from the ground up in AEW, hooked off on his own fucking pipe bomb, left the company. We didn't even know he was coming back until all of a sudden at the end of that pay-per-view, I forget the name of the pay-per-view, where they're playing the fucking audio between him and Tony, whether that's, you know, queued up and docketed or if that's like the actual recording and shit like that, and him getting a fucking Stone Cold level pop, and then you see him level up into he becomes your top champion. He defeats CM Punk. I believe he also defeats Moxley. Earlier in this year, he put on a 5-star classic with Daniel Bryan in a fucking Iron Man match. He just main evented All in the hottest angle in AEW with his best friend Adam Cole that at some point they're going to run back. Are we not talking about MJF? We're talking about homegrown talent, to where he's already told Tony Khan to his face, like, bro, I want to be here, but you got to back up the brain truck. Like, I haven't seen anyone elevate their stock that high. Mm-hmm. So, boom.
Mic drop.
I know, mic drop, because she said, who's the best and who would you choose?
No, I didn't say who's the best. Oh, Patricia, you're talking about Patricia's question?
Yeah.
But it's a
bunch. So that means I had one choice.
If we can go to Andre's.
Yeah.
But if we can go to Andre's response, like he literally says, the fan base and the audience of AEW, the diehard ones, they don't care. Like, and it's weird to say, is it a weirdo wrestling thing? Yeah, they don't give a rat's ass who's on whose radio station or popping up on whose concert or who's going to whose tour. They care about who they're looking to pay the ticket to see. And I get it. Like, Jade has done a phenomenal job as somebody who works in AEW, who's not a WWE face, who's able to literally go out there and like, oh my god, that's Jay Cargill, like, oh my god, like, to have this appeal outside of AEW, we get it. But you also have to think of the people again who are there that are gonna hold shit down. Like, the next person, if second to none next to Jay, that second to none in that box. And it's hard to say who's the best because there's so many. Like, for example, Sky Blue got the biggest pop at Rev Pro that I've ever seen a female talent get, and she's young. Like, she's like, her and, mind you, this is somebody who used to wrestle with Roxy and all these other people in the pros back when Ring of Honor was Ring of Honor before. Like, she got the biggest pop in England that I've ever seen a young lady get on an indie pay-per-view. That's huge. She's next. Like, we talk about Willow Nightingale. Like, Willow Nightingale, we've known. We've watched her even before she got signed to AEW. But look at her appeal in AEW now without even having that big of a hype. She's a draw. So I think of these homegrown talents, again, as people who's going to be around, even if they say, listen, I got to do a movie. MJF just did a goddamn movie. And like, let's be real, but he's still back. You get what I'm saying? So that's just where my thought process is with it. Love you, Jade. Just saying. If you're ever watching this, still love you. Still
we
queen.
Love you, Jay. And we I think you, it Jay. All just comes down to, like, how do you define a homegrown talent? There are a million and one. I'm exaggerating. There's a million and one. Wrestling promotions out there, indie and all that,
and the Acclaimed as a tag team for sure, and Private Party.
Come out.
So I
agree
wanna...
with you, Nikki. That other, we got another comment that's funny as hell.
Oh, yeah.
So
if you this should be our screenshot for our thumbnail. Like,
me finally took off them Target boots. About time.
Yes.
Yeah,
if you from New York City,
yeah.
Do you lace up your Timbs?
How do you make your Timbs or constructs? That's how you know you're really from New York if you call them constructs. There's a way to wear them. And let me just say, Noah and I do not approve of how he was wearing them. They was a little on the choke side.
Yo, they was choking them ankles. Their ankles was like, help me, help me.
They don't even got the tree icon. They got the mushroom icon. That's how knockoff they are. Yeah.
So okay, let's get into the Acclaim, just to switch gears into tag team wrestling, because Noah also mentioned the tag team wrestling and the trios championship. We'll get into that too. But let's talk about the Acclaimed in the tag team division and tag team wrestling in AEW in general, because just like in that press conference, they talked about how they were going to do, they basically want to do everything WWE was not, and that was to emphasize tag team wrestling and women's wrestling. I don't know how great they've done that, but I think we should talk about the tag team.
They definitely have emphasized tag team wrestling.
Let's talk about it.
They definitely have emphasized tag team wrestling. It goes all the way back to the Young Bucks and then them getting the Lucha Brothers, from them getting Santana Ortiz, Jericho bumping down, starting Jericho Appreciation Society, and then the Acclaimed is the best version of this, where, you know, the same way WWE will put two guys together to see if it works, with like the Bar and other makeshift tag teams. They did that with the Acclaimed. It took a while for them to get over, but then once they got over like rubber, to where I've gone on Fan Club many a times and been like, I don't understand the scissoring shit. Is it consensual? What the fuck is this? Two grown ass people doing this shit? Make it make sense. But then when I pulled up to an AEW Dynamite in DC and watched it in person and saw just everyone just like, turn to your left, turn to your right, scissor your friends and shit like that. And like everyone was fucking like going nuts for this. I was like, yo, they really have something here. This is very organic, to where no bullshit. It's like, all right, the raps or whatever, but people love it. People love Bowens. People love badass Billy Gunn. And it just really got to a point to where, was it Swerve and Keith were tag team champions and people wanted them, like, nah, get them shits off of them, put on the Acclaimed like immediately. We want them as your tag team champions. And just the way they got pushed to where you see it at All In. They face House of Black. House of Black has not taken an L all year since they've gotten those titles. They're undefeated. And for them to take those trios titles off of them in the co-main event of All In just shows the progression of like, yo, we really fuck with the Acclaimed, but now we're really put money behind you in a way that we haven't really seen them do that. But there's a company that from day one, they've emphasized tag team wrestling from the jump. The women's division, it may be stop and go progress, but the tag team division, nah, they've always been here for that.
The way that, and like P and Brian know, the way that the building literally gets quiet every time they're ready to hear what Mattcaster has to rap about, like, that is a sign. Like, remember how it used to be, like, we talk about, and rest in peace always to Bray Wyatt, the way that you used to literally, you made sure your battery was charged so that you could be a firefly in the audience. The way that certain things in the audience being included make a big difference. Like, I ain't never seen people get that quiet in an arena in Newark of all places, then waiting to see what waiting to see what the rap was going to be about. And the same thing happened to Collision, which is why I'll be saying that clip of Buddy drop kicking the shit out of Max. He was like, you're not going there tonight, buddy. We're not talking about my missus. You should be shutting this shit down. No, I don't care what Tony says backstage. I'm ending it. Like, people were like actively quiet, and that's the impact they make. And me too, like, my, it's funny because I have, there are people that I know that do that shit in public. I went to a bar with my brother, shout out to my brother, and they were like guys doing the whole scissor me. So I'm like, these are grown ass men, but they're doing it. And that's the, again, impacting, and people, and to the point where people are asking, what's the scissoring thing about? And people actually find out and they're like, wait, then why are they, you know what, like they don't get it, but you have to be an AEW fan to get it. So I think their impact is great. I think what the catalyst for all this, somebody mentioned Penta and Ray, like shout out to them. I also think they add to the mix. I think a lot of it is, it's good. That's where I feel like the Bucks is great for business, because they understand the importance of tag team wrestling And they were like, no, let's build the vision. Let's actually focus on the vision. Like, what can we do? Like, who can we go up against? And all the people even have the FTR there, which they, when they were in WWE, they were the same type of stature. Now they're at AEW and there's, they weren't appreciated as much, according, allegedly, but they're at the same stature where they are in AEW, so where they've also been against everybody and they've been able to put on matches with some great tag teams. Why? Because their division is where, is ideally where it's supposed to be, and it's going to go higher from here.
Mm-hmm. But that's the beauty of AEW, which is like, WWE is like, these are the toys WWE discarded. It's like, fine, we will take them and we will use them. FTR, we will use them properly. Tony Storm, you don't got to worry about getting cream pied on TV. You'll be used properly. Ruby Soho, you'll be used properly. Mm-hmm. And so on and so forth. Adam Cole would never have probably main evented a Big Four pay-per-view had he stayed in WWE. You just saw him main event All In.
False.
He's not going to.
False. It would have happened eventually.
He would have got no. It. So I'm 50-50 on that solely because part of me would have think he would have made a great heavyweight champion, because you can see he would have made a great WWE champion, probably not an undisputed, because I feel like the undisputed is the new heavyweight and the WWE championship is what it used to be. Like, you see it on Seth Rollins. Him and Seth Rollins would have put on bangers. But do I think it would have taken they would have strangled him a little bit longer? I definitely think they would have. He would have had a couple of Intercontinental Championship runs. He probably would have been a tag team with somebody else. Like, none of them went to main roster when you think about it. But I don't think, I have to agree with Justin on the fuss of he wouldn't have main evented. In my opinion, he wouldn't have main evented in WWE.
You just gotta remember, real quick,
breaking news, him and MJF are set to defend their tag titles this Sunday at All Out against the winner of the tag team battle royal from Rampage.
Again.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Okay.
I hear you on Adam Cole, Brian. It's just got to remember, A, who runs WWE, and B, remember, Adam Cole came off a very serious head injury. And you know, mm-hmm. WWE is zero fucking tolerance with that.
When did this happen?
No.
Was it brain, or was it? Because my thing is, at the end of the day, I just see him as mini Shawn Michaels. Would have been a while. I mean, we've been so accustomed to the microwave of champions.
Not the microwave.
We
dude.
Have. We've been so accustomed to the microwave and seeing people. We forget it took Bret Hart, 7 to 12 years? Shawn Michaels, 7 to 12 years. I think we're getting that. Now again, but it's just because we have so much access and they putting on more shows. That's all. I still believe eventually, you know, he would have had a Big Four, even if it was just Survivor Series. He would have had a four. It might have been in 2026, 2027, you know, but it would have been him and Jay Bougie.
Never say never, because he's in AEW and AEW likes to cross over their opponents. When so who's gets, to say he'll have more of a chance doing that? And
he'll go back and be a bigger star. Watch. It's 9 o'clock and Statlander's on.
Do you see?
I don't doubt like, you, Brian. It's just WWE's track history is like, yeah. You say they Brett and Sean. They put all
their hype.
You say Brett and Sean is like, bro, they got forced to push Brett and Sean because no Hogan, no Macho
but
Man.
10 years no ago, yeah. 5 years ago, Gunther wouldn't be in this position because he's international. So,
right, and he's the Intercontinental Champion.
But he wouldn't have been that. He would have been a gimmick. Look at Heidenreich.
No, they were always high. I'm sorry. They were always high on Gunther. I'm trying to forget Heidenreich.
Thanks a lot.
They were always high on Gunther.
Michael Cole, was that Michael Cole?
If there's any talent that they were able to come to an existence degree on, both of the Triple H and Vince, it was always Gunther. Even when he was motherfucking Walter, they were always high on him. It's reports saying that they were always high on him. So there's no doubt in that. They just had to put more personality behind him, and that's where Imperium came from. So that's where that is. But as far as Adam Cole, the way they let them run NXT and then it fizzled out the way it did, where they had almost nothing for them, you can tell if they got to main roster, it would have been the exact same thing. So he saw the writing on the wall of that, and he also, like everybody else, he saw his friends thriving in a new company, and he went to AEW. Like, the books to his friends.
That's the thing. AEW killed NXT the way we used to have it. That's right. The reason why they had to hit the reset button. But you know, because if it wasn't for AEW, granted,
he wasn't gonna be down with new NXT. There's no way.
No, there wouldn't have been an NXT 2.0 because all the indie darlings would have done exactly what the Tyler Blacks, what the Dean Ambroses did. They would have been through coming through the NXT portion because what was your best shot to get on TV would have been Impact Wrestling. AEW gave an alternative, but at the same time, it also killed the indie effect that NXT used to have.
Right. Okay. That's true. I get it now. That's actually true.
I agree.
I agree with that.
So how do we feel about, I'm just thinking of just things that make AEW different. The trios titles and all of the different championships that are in AEW. How we feel about that?
I like Orange Cassidy, so I can't speak much on that. So I'm biased.
No, that's a beautiful belt though.
I like that belt. I'm sorry. It fits him. He's carrying it around. He's keeping it safe in a book bag. I could appreciate him for that. So you're not going to get me to talk anything. I like the ideas of a trios championship because that's another thing that it gives something for the staples to have. Mm-hmm. So I like that. I actually like the trios championships a lot. Like House of Black holding it made the most sense to me. And that's why I adored it so much because you finally given Malakai Black a purpose to why he created House of Black in the first place. So I like that. But I'm also looking forward to see how many other trios they can create.
I'm not a real big fan of trios, but I understand it. Mm-hmm. You know, it does get more people on the card. It gets more people paid. So for that part, I do like it.
It's a staple tie because, you know, remember when the biggest complaint was when they had too many stables?
So that's let's pause right there, right? Mm-hmm. That's what I would rather see. I would rather see a bunch of different stables have it and you do the Freebird rule. Except say if you got five people, any of those three can be a champion. That's how I feel about that. But overall, you know, with all I like that. With you know, like you said, the international championship, it gives the opportunity to showcase the international talents, and you know, so I'm down for that. But the belts look gorgeous, I have to say.
I like me some trios. As someone that watches New Japan Pro Wrestling and watches them do the trios championships, like, when done right, it could be fantastic addition to the division, and especially with like New Japan, where everyone's like in stables and whatnot. So you get to see like different versions of that stable wrestle, and especially where it's like you got your top guy in the stable, you got your second in command who's probably gonna get pushed high up, and then it gives the rest of that stable something to do.
Mm-hmm. How do we feel about the TBS championship going forward? Like, where do you see its future?
That's your women's mid-card title, if we're being dead ass. Like, we were saying secondary titles for the women all across, like, especially in WWE, where it's like, yo, do away with these dual titles, have one top title, have an IC title, have your women's tag team title. So with AEW, your TBS title can be your secondary title for your women's championship. And that's how you build a division.
Yeah, I think at the end of the day, you got all the ingredients to make a good meal. So it's just like start using it. I definitely, that's how I feel. You got all the ingredients, you know, put the meal together. And, you know, so when you talk about the TBS championship, at first I didn't like the fact it looked just like the TNT title. But then it's like, well, it kind of makes sense, you know, so. I do like the fact that it's literally the same size. They didn't like say, oh, well, you know, you don't deserve to hold a big belt, you know.
Yeah. Okay, that's the best thing I noticed too. Like, a lot of women's belts are small. And then you had like WWE finally make theirs like as heavy as the males. And I was like, oh, thank God. Like, don't give them like some flimsy little thing you can kick to the side. Like, put some weight on that bad boy. Like, make sure I get my foot hurt when I'm kicking it.
That's why I was glad they adjusted the women's championship.
Remember that first one? That tiny little one where it's like,
The women's champion was like so circling. And then the Divas championship was literally like, I keep thinking about that time that Alberto Del Rio kicked it. I was like, Daddy, you could tell it ain't heavy because if it had some weight on it, it wouldn't even flew. It flew, honey. Mm-hmm. To the point when they changed it, I was like, okay, now like she got a little meat on her.
Did it fly because that belt was lighter because the Rio was on some
Don't stop, 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 stop. I'm gonna stop you right there. Moving on. How do we feel about what do you think the purpose of the FTW championship really is? Everybody's opinion.
I mean, I don't like the fact that there are like so many championships because I think it kind of dilutes it to a certain extent, if not booked the right way. But as like a fan of Taz and all of that, like I'm not mad at it, you know, like his son holding it. So I mean, I think it's fun. I think it's a different fun title. Like, yeah, that's how I feel.
Yeah, yeah, I leave it at that. It's appreciation night.
It's appreciation night. Nice. I think it's meant for Hook. In my opinion, that's where I'm gonna leave that. It's fun. Now the TNT Championship, it looked good on Ricky Starks. I'm saying,
yeah, shout out to Ricky Stark. We're giving him his flowers right now. This is Thursday, yeah. We would toast to him. Shout out to Ricky Stark. Shout out to Danny Garcia because I found myself loving the dance. Like I am so into. All of that. Somebody posted a compilation on Twitter of all the times that he randomly started doing the dance, and it sold me. I'm like, so
that's that New York stuff.
These guys understand you got to entertain at the end. Yeah, of the day.
You can't help it.
That's what it's all about.
If we want to be real, that was what separated Kurt Angle and Ken Shamrock. And while Ken Shamrock was entertaining, Kurt Angle was just more entertaining. And
right,
the championship, and that's the reason why you know he's one of the greatest to ever do it because you know they always talk about nobody came into the business and understood it more and better than Kurt Angle,
right?
You know,
and yeah, listen, I will always give Eddie Kingston his flowers because he's literally again foundation, like, and beyond it, too, he's a truth teller because he be telling people stuff. And it'd be coming to full fruition, dirt sheet or not dirt sheet. He was just like, I don't give a fuck. I'm here to fight. I'm here to whoop ass. Like, you saw the way he came out of All In. Like, he ain't wait to do no special shit. He said, I know who I'm gunning for, and I'm gunning. And he literally was gunning. He said, we said stampede, we march. So respect to him because he doesn't get enough credit, I feel like, for being a fighter. Yes. But he doesn't get enough credit for being the fighter that he is. And I think that's why people here, especially in the tri-state area, they love them some Eddie Kingston because of that. Like, it's that old school that street. Drama. When I see you, I see you, and now I'm here no matter what because I'm me type shit. So I always appreciate that.
No, same. And I wouldn't call Eddie Kingston a homegrown talent.
Well, I call him the starters.
Like this is his moment. Like he's capitalized on this moment 1,000%.
All those promos you talked about, Andre, is him telling the truth because he's been around for that long. Like, remember, he was before this, he was doing MLW and a whole bunch of other things. So he's seen shit, he knows shit. He was young when he started. Like, his promo with CM Punk, I'm like, yo, I really forgot. He had a small stink in Ring of Honor. And people were like, he an elephant. He don't forget nothing. So he's going to tell you like it is. Sometimes I think he forgets he's supposed to be working. I think he thinks this is real. And that's what makes it authentic.
Ruby Soho just stole Chris Statlander's championship.
Oh, I like it.
Okay. And then,
it's giving Nyla Rose, though, but I like it. Because then Nyla Rose are the same thing.
That was a dope match.
I'm not a fan of stealing the belts, you know, but I get it. And when I say not a fan, not as in I'm booking the show. I'm talking about literally in kayfabe. Like, I'm being a fan here. Like, don't do that. Give it back.
I'm just saying Nyla Rose already did that. But
I'm in kayfabe, but I'm also not a Ruby Soho fan either.
Look at you sound like a parent. That's not yours. Give it back.
Yeah, that's not nice.
Do the right thing. Come on.
Give it back.
That's not right.
Be nice now. I don't like that. Give it back.
Oh, wow. God. I taught you better.
Not my fault y'all don't understand what the word homegrown talent means.
First of all... your high production ass somewhere else. Because
if that's the case, MJF ain't a homegrown talent since you want to bring up MLW, buddy.
Oh, my God.
I'm joking. I moved on.
You know you have not, but okay. Now you moved on.
That is not moving on. That's not moving on. In the dark until you have your shot.
That's you going pew, 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 pew.
Because that's what she did, right? She took a bunch of shots in the song, and she told the dude she was moving on. But I did. I'm out.
All right, so to close out this appreciation night, I want to talk about what I personally appreciate most about AEW, because what Brian H. Waters?
Getting Samoa Joe versus Shane Taylor for the TV championship at All
Out. Wait, what?
Samoa Joe versus Shane Taylor for the Always TV title.
Yes, Shane Taylor production.
Huge. We love that. Shane Taylor's family. Love this. That's amazing. Yeah, we got a sound effect.
Joe can give him back his belt.
I got the chance to witness him and Kenny King had a fight in Baltimore in the last Ring of Honor show. Shout out to Rev Ron Hunt.
Yeah,
that's when they did the, I don't know if that was the last show, but I was at the show when they did the fist. Man, like, bro.
What?
When they, the Black Power fist.
Okay.
I didn't say that when they started fisting.
No, inappropriate. That wasn't that one of the last shows that Ring of Honor had before the sale?
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember. That was Trent.
Huh?
That was Trent.
They also, All right, got you. Mm-hmm. They also did it in Baltimore.
Yeah.
And Caprice Coleman came out. I watched all these people run out there.
That was in Baltimore.
Yeah. And so, Shane Taylor and Kenny King, they beat the hell out of each other and then shook hands afterwards.
Thank you for tuning in.
To, you know, family members. So, you know, I want Shane Taylor to, like, get his bag. That's why, like, I'm super excited for this one.
It's time. And that's another, like, reason why we mentioned before, one of the things that we appreciated about Tony Khan was him buying ROH, because it gives somebody like Samoa Joe Shane Taylor the opportunity to wrestle someone like Samoa Joe and finally get kind of that elevation that we always knew they deserved. We mentioned Athena. Shout out to Athena, everything she's doing out there. Mm-hmm. I think it was Nikki Bougie. I'm not sure who tweeted it that said that she's probably the greatest or one of the best women's champion in the game right now, and I think I might have to agree, because she's defending it, she's putting on bangers, she has this renewed sense of purpose. I think ROH is exactly where she needs to be. Shout out to Willow Nightingale and all the talent. Shout out to, you know, Jay Bougie and like other people we've seen come up that have been given the opportunity to be on Dark and wrestle on TV for the first time. That's huge. Mm-hmm. You know, I want to also mention all the programming that AEW has on television. Like, no one thought that another wrestling promotion would be able to get these time slots. We mentioned the reality shows. You know, a lot of them. Okay. No, you're right. Yeah, our indie kings out there getting their job done, and that's why we love that there's that other outlet and platform. But I do want to close out Appreciation Night with what I particularly love about it. And actually, before we do that, Andre,
I like mentioned... what we're for. Yeah.
Yes, go ahead, Brian.
Oh, I was just saying I liked it. That's all. Go ahead. You was in it.
No, I appreciate that, like, him, JR, a lot of other personalities that get to kind of have this next stage of their careers. Like, JR has said that this is the most fun that he's had in the wrestling business, and we know how long his career has been in this industry. So I love that.
Tony Schiavone in this household, because you don't understand how much Tony Schiavone has done for the business. Like, Brian knows probably a little bit more people. We stand Tony Schiavone in this house. We also stand Taz. I always love Taz
has on commentary and the fact that he was able to get back into doing it and even had to watch his son and have that little fraction he had for a while. Love it.
You know, like also I love is getting a second chance over an AEW that W was not using anymore. Justin Roberts.
Yes.
One thing that's important is being like an in-ring announcer and just that, you know, Kenny, oh, like the way he announces, like we give Samantha Irving her much deserved flowers, but like Justin Roberts is also like one of the best in the game.
We gotta do a ring announcers appreciation night and just because they have a big part, but you know, they're not like always a showcase. And I think that's cool to give them some flowers as well. But I want to touch on Nikki Bougie's comment that she left earlier. Is AEW is much better in person. And I don't watch AEW weekly. Again, I appreciate everything it's doing. But I was able to go to my first AEW show last year. I want to say Full Gear. And the reason why I was pressed to go was, one, I wanted to go to an AEW show with Siendole because I know she was such a fan. Saraya was making her debut back into wrestling. And it was in New York. So there was a Jersey. But it was a lot of moving parts. And I was like, okay, I think I kind of want to go. And I had the time of my life. I will say, like, it is the best to go in person. And the reason why I appreciated it was because of the simple fact that it was so different from going to a WWE show. At this point, I've gone to countless live events, pay-per-views, Raw, SmackDowns, all of the above. AEW was the first one I went to. And I could say, like, it was so much fun. It was a long ass show, but I felt like I was there for like an hour. I think it also had to do with who I was there with. You know, Brian H. Waters, Cal, a lot of the other like media, Emilio.
Oh, I love me Emilio. He was cool.
Facts. It was one of those sorts of nights, and I loved everything about it. It has a completely different feel. There's not as many kids. You can definitely tell that this is an adult crowd, that they are catering to an adult crowd. They had a specialty drink menu with drinks named after the wrestlers and tailored to that night. So there's a lot of like little nuggets that I appreciated that isn't like the other promotion. But how did you guys feel? And I also want to just note too, before I hear what the crew feels about going to AEW shows live, is a lot of people told me that that first AEW pay-per-view that they ever had, even before they were like a promotion, was one of the best wrestling shows they had ever been to ever. These are lifelong wrestling fans. They're not necessarily AEW fans. They're just saying that the experience of going to something that was so new, so fresh, was magical. I think about Mercedes Moné being at Wembley this weekend. Like, it's not about being an AEW fan or a WWE fan. It's about being a wrestling fan and seeing history being made, being in an electrifying stadium with almost 100,000 other wrestling fans. That's what this is all about. So that's what I appreciate most about AEW, is that the live event experience is like none other, and it's still growing. It's still evolving. They're just getting international. So those shows are probably only gonna get better. So how do you guys feel about visiting the show? Like, did anyone go to the first show? What's it like being in the stands?
Well, when I be talking about, like, my man, I think it's my man, my first man was P, because P was the first person to ever give me tickets to a AEW show. So I want to say thank you to my man. Thank you to my girl.
Happy birthday.
It was a good birthday gift. All in all, it was fun. Like, especially, like I said, being there with you two. Like, you always talk about, oh my God. Like, the fact that I got to sing that live with my friends. Again, can't take that away from me. Me and Brian were like the top of our lungs. We didn't care. Just like it was good to sing Cody Rhodes' theme song. It was fun. The experience of itself is fun. You see it on TV, you don't get the hype, but then when you're there in person, it was a good, well-rounded show. It was the show that MJF had won the title, which was also, for me, it was great to see. Like, it was a lot, not just Jersey, it was Long Island, it was Connecticut was in the building. You know, yet people impressed that are far and wide. It was a good show production-wise. It was a really good show. Like, a lot of times I always joke that in most wrestling shows, I can't tell what's going on. But AEW, I could definitely tell what was going on. So I appreciate them on that spectrum. Mm-hmm. Especially on a live show, it's hard because you're so used to like commentary and somebody giving direction and shit you can't see. Even when they were having their little like stadium stampede, because they had one there too, I could still see and understand what was going on. So I could appreciate that. Now with Collision felt a lot more intimate because it wasn't just, it was my first show that I realized it wasn't a lot of men. It was men and women there. Like I always say, I met Action Andretti's mom. I ended up sitting next to her at Collision. And then, like I said, like the people love them some Ricky Stark, women and men. So it was good to see that. I got to see a Ring of Honor show. I got to see like Powerhouse Hobbs wrestle. And then they had a show after. So you get like people were always wondering. And I was one of those people too that's like, why is it so much goddamn money to go to an AEW show? And I realized going to Collision, I'm like, oh, I'm getting three shows for the price of one. Now we make it sense. So people joke, I was the one, and I'm guilty. I said I wasn't going to watch no wrestling on a Saturday, but I take it back. If I was bored and it came back to Newark, I'd be like, you know what? It starts at 7. I get a pre-show, the main live show, and then another show after. I will go. Like, mm-hmm. I don't have a problem with going. So they hit the mark on that to bring that value into a live show to where it's like, we're not just going to have you sit for Collision and go home. Like, no, we're actually going to tape Ring of Honor, or we're going to tape this, or we're going to do a couple of promos, or you guys going to be a part of like a pre-taping. Like, I like that a lot. So they wanted my book on that aspect. I see why people love the show.
Same.
I'll say this. I went to one in Baltimore County, which is at the UMBC's, I guess you call it like their sports arena, and they just got new trios tag belts. Oh, they look like they're pink for the play.
I like it.
Like they really? Look like a no, yeah, they look like they're like a reddish pink for the Acclaim. Shout out to them, but that's another thing. That's really kind of cool that they always switch up the belts. But
what else? Scissor Day. When they had like custom giant pink.
Oh
scissors.
Shoot, yeah, like the belt. So you know where the straps.
Wait, what?
Like scissors.
I need to see this. Go ahead.
Yeah, the belt, the back of the belt, scissor. But unlike DC and unlike Jersey, those shows were like in big arenas, right? So in UMBC, it's probably like hold like 6,000. 7,000 people. Of course, you look at it on TV, it looks like, oh, okay, looks good. So you really appreciate the fans there because it's like you hear everything. It's kind of like, because like when NXT would come to town, they would run the smaller venues as well. So when you watch an AEW Dynamite in a smaller venue, you can really like, it's almost like you can hear the wrestlers, not like talking to each other, but like they can almost like hear every word and the high crowd participation. Right. So that's the one thing that I can really appreciate about going to a live show, especially like a smaller venue show, is that you can really just kind of like it's got that intimate feel that I can imagine people who were huge fans of the NWA back in the day when it was like very mm-hmm. prestigious, like that studio wrestling S feel, but just a little bit bigger.
And for me, what I like about AEW shows is like I get more action at AEW shows versus WWE, where depending on where it falls on the WWE's calendar, whether it's like a go home show, whether they're building towards something, you don't know if you're going to get like 3/5 sports entertainment, 2/5 wrestling versus AEW is like there's a lot more action. There's a lot more wrestling. You get more bang for your buck, especially if it's one of those package deals where it's like, you're there for a Rampage, but you're getting 2 hours of additional wrestling on top of that. Or we're doing Dynamite, we're also doing this stuff afterwards. Mm-hmm. And as someone has been to Dynamite, Rampage, Dark Elevation, Full Gear, and also like Brian, I went to the first AEW Dynamite in DC, where it's just like, those crowds are different because WWE, it's families, it's kids, versus there's a lot of grown-ass adults that's like, we're all here for the same thing. So when it's like a great crowd in unison, It's a big difference compared to WWE, where it's like you're not gonna get those same reactions, those same crowds.
Agreed. And it's also exciting just to see firsts again. Like the other company's been around 50 years, and everything that you know AEW does at this point is gonna feel fresh. Going to a new show is gonna feel new if you've never been, and that's exciting. And I think it's definitely moving the needle as far as the future of this business, because there's an alternative, because there's competition, because there's other places that some of our favorite wrestlers can go for opportunities to show their craft. And then it just brings more fans into the building.
Hold on. Brian Keith will be facing Hangman Page this Friday.
Wait, who?
Brian Keith.
Wait,
Who? Brian Keefe.
Well, thank God I don't have a
Battle
date.
Club Pro in the opening.
Thank God I don't have a date because now I know what I'm watching.
Was I? I don't think I was at Battle Club Pro.
You weren't at Battle Club Pro. Brian Keefe. Love us some Brian
Keefe. Next up.
I went over my head.
He's from Texas. Yeah, bounty hunter.
Good for him. That's awesome.
Yeah, he was one of the people I was very happy to get a chance. Janelle told me go talk to him and meet him. I didn't get.
They say he's cool.
Hot that day. Yeah. And then I think he was actually, he was there the next day when I went and saw Jay Bougie at Ridgefield. He was at that show as well.
Nice.
But I'm glad to see him because you see, shout out to Cal. Cal and Black Wrestling put through the BRP 50, kind of helped me like understand, like, okay, he's like that dude. And that's kind of where you go to know who's up next.
FTR Carter and the Young Bucks are going up against the Bullet Club Gold at All Out.
Three-way tag team title match. Triple threat tag team.
Okay. We'd love to see that.
I want to see how this crowd reacts now that their boy's not there.
I think they'll be better than anticipated. I think they're going to
next time they're in Newark or Long Island or Queens or wherever AEW does their shows, we'll definitely all try to go because it's pretty fun.
I actually, too, though, is on my bucket list now to try and make it to a DC show because Justin convinced me that the crowds are different with wrestling down there. So that's like an Amtrak trip I'm willing to make. Why are you wavering?
You know why he's doing that.
I'm not coming to Baltimore Island. It's not happening. So I'm going to DC.
Extra 50 miles on your car. It's cool.
No, I'm taking the Amtrak. It's cheaper. And I just paid $20. Instead of paying $20 to go to Baltimore, I just paid $20 the whole way to go to DC.
Which is better.
I do want to also do a fan club one day on like some of the best wrestling cities and what like in different crowds.
I gotta hear about.
Don't say "oh Lord" because we're not gonna bring up Baltimore, Justin.
Bro, you're gonna bring up Baltimore. You know Baltimore's a great crowd.
It's gonna be contended, so.
Just because then it comes into the Corpus Christi, Texas slander, and then. Slander in that city and
big fun in Baltimore.
Slandering city. We're just talking about the best cities that we like to enjoy wrestling in. That's all. We don't like to be negative. We try not to be, but you know.
Do I get a day off?
Who slanders Corpus Christi?
All right. No,
WWE likes it. It's good enough. Nothing. Allegedly.
I mean, it can't be worse than Lafayette, Louisiana. Those are all the slander.
Stop.
Whoa. The hotels at Lafayette
were great for WrestleMania for a lot of people. I would not have.
And we got fans down there. We got fan club fans down there.
I love Louisiana, but man, I'm never going to forget that one Raw.
Dude. We time out.
So, first of all, Black Thoughts, we're not doing that. Huh?
Can we throw Catsuit in the box?
We are going to throw Castle in the box. We're not throwing Siendole in the box. I'm just making sure
they know.
It's overused because it was from a very special night. If he was there, you there. If you know, you know.
If he wasn't, you wasn't.
So leave it alone.
Yes, but the moral of the Castle story is that Siendole's a motherfucking baddie. And I think that's pretty much
without a section, honey.
That's really all that is. We are not slandering the Bronx at all. We did not slander AEW tonight, which I'm very, very proud of. Because again, if you're a wrestling fan, you gotta appreciate what it's
Black doing Thoughts. Because I adore you, I will one day when you come back up here tell you about the Kazu story.
But He was there.
So
fucking mic drop of an entrance.
Shout out to my people from the BRP, but it's their event. Yes, shout out to my people from the BRP, but it's their story and their story only. Let's leave it at that.
Oh yes, I got another Bronx person in the building. So Black Thoughts, chill.
Okay, she has soldiers now.
Yes, I do. Thank you very much. That's how it is in the Boogie Down. But I do want to thank everyone, of course, for joining us. No matter where you're from, we love everyone that comes to the fan club every week, every Wednesday, 7 p.m. Eastern on Twitch. where you can find me and my crew here. We talk about a variety of subjects, and tonight we just happened to go into AEW Appreciation. We actually figured out what the next two fan clubs will be about. We're gonna recap the summer and all the wrestling events that we've done this summer, all the amazing shows that happened. It'll be right after Labor Day weekend, so it'll be a nice way to recap and get into this next quarter of the year. And then the week after that, we are going to do a hashtag TNA, Total Nonstop Action Appreciation, where we go into the origins of Impact Wrestling and some of the things that we appreciated about it. Because just everything that we like about AEW that we mentioned, like, TNA was doing a lot of that after Vince bought up all the fucking wrestling promotions and there was nothing else, and they were able to do an alternative that was really fun and really fostered a lot of big stars that are now big stars in WWE. Shout out to AJ Styles, Samoa Joe, and a lot of people we even mentioned tonight doing their thing in AEW. But we also like to get feedback from you guys. We want to do a fan club on anything that in wrestling that you love. So if you have a recommendation or a topic you want to lead us on, just let us know in the comments, tweet us, comment, hashtag TWG fan club, invite a friend that loves wrestling. This is a great space to do that. Again, shout out to our VIP. We will do an Omos fan club one day. You know, I have a feeling that he's going to have a moment that will call for it, and you will definitely be our special guest on that episode. Black Thoughts, all jokes aside, I'm very happy to see you back in New York. I love that you're close. You have been a friend and family of the pod for years. We love you. We love you too, Keith. And we will see you all next week. But before then, where can everybody find you guys?
Well, you can find me on all social media platforms at It's Justin Rich. Friday morning, we are dropping our review, Justin Rich Talks AEW All In. We will be busy these next couple of days between dropping our review for All In, watching WWE Payback, and watching AEW All Out. So next week, obviously, we'll be having reviews for those. You're getting three reviews in a matter of like a week, so your boy's going to be very, very busy with the content creation on that. You can also catch me Wednesday nights here on Twitch from 7 to 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for a TWG fan club, myself, and these three beautiful, illustrious, intelligent co-hosts of mine. You can catch me Tuesday nights, Twitter Spaces, around 6:35 p.m. for Turnbuckle Talk with me and Corey, where we talk all things wrestling. You can catch me from time to time on True Hill Heat Sports and True Hill Heat Wrestling, both of the channels are located on YouTube, where we talk sports, wrestling, and all that fun stuff. Your boy was on there doing a live stream with the True Hill Heat crew for AEW All In. So we watched this pay-per-view live and direct. So, you know, I'm going to have some thoughts on this review. We here, we outside, we active. Salute to AEW going on year 5. Continue the growth. Continue to get better. Thankful you're here.
You find me at Brian H. Waters on all social media platforms. Hit the Google machine.
Okay, that's some celebrity shit right there. He said, "Google me."
I can't hear them.
What the hell was that? It's like, you know me. I'm here. End of story.
It's kind of like
you can't make it short. What kind of BS is that?
I gotta stay where to find her.
Yeah, hit the Google machine. Like,
what type of Hollywood shit is that? What, you're writing that for you?
Like, Google me. Love and Hip Hop. You don't even have a Wikipedia page. You got a Wikipedia page, bitch. Shout out to Kim Michelle. You guys, next thing you're gonna be like, listen, my Wikipedia page is up next week. Listen.
Who needs Wikipedia when I have like a 5-page Squarespace layout?
Listen, you're a household name on fan club now, so do shit traditionally, okay? It's not telling you to change the platform because you're Hollywood now, okay?
Ain't nobody Hollywood. I'm homegrown talent. Brian H. Waters.
Homegrown Waters. Okay, there you go.
Brian
H. Waters. We joke, but we love you, Brian. And we appreciate you. Yep.
Yeah.
The good thing is, all your platforms actually are the same. So it actually is very easy to find Brian H. Waters. And all the amazing work that he does.
He learned from the best.
Ooh. Yeah, me.
Yeah. 10:30 wrestling realm party tonight. We got D from Dot Sportnet coming through. So yeah, make sure y'all check that out. Make sure you check out Wednesday Worldwide. We had a fun conversation. Booked Mercedes Moné and Soraya for the AEW Women's Championship, and how do we get there? And let's just say Cruise Control, aka Ben, went cruising and had some bars for CM Punk, which I'm proud that we didn't get into and destroy today. So yeah, y'all check those out. And of course, be sure be here every Wednesday and Wednesday morning. If you missed it, Fan Club drops at midnight. So make sure y'all check that out.
We love a good YouTube playback. Again, save the date. November 4th is our fifth anniversary event here in New York City. More information will be coming out. So if you are not already following us everywhere or signed up to our newsletter, please make sure you do that. ThoseWrestlingGirls.com. We'll have a lot more opportunities for sponsorship, guesting, guest hosting. We have a lot going on. So make sure you follow us for that. Check out our latest episode with at Seahawk. So many names. It's a very good conversation. Hey. If you think you know him, you do not know him, please check out that interview. It is so, so good. Our new season of live episodes starts up next month. So make sure you follow us for that. We want you all to be a part of it here on Twitch. And I think that that's about it. Shout out to Aware and all
that's
of
about
it.
Someone ain't hook off on her.
I meant that was it as far as CWG updates.
Oh, I got scared. I was like, did I miss that?
I'm gonna give Siendole her time to close out, but I just I wanted to put out those updates because I tend to disrupt, but those are the TWG updates for the universe. And now Siendole, you can close us.
I get
out.
To close out.
Yes.
I'm gonna make this so special. Okay.
My bad.
And per usual, yes, ladies and gentlemen, it is your honorary wrestling girl, Siendole B. You can find me on all my platforms at reload.relive. You can find me on Instagram. You can find me on whatever it decides to be today at reload via film. You can actually also catch me on YouTube. You can Google that. And that's Siendole B on YouTube. And aside, my website is in all my links in my bios. And when I'm not sitting here trying to make up and finally finish a blog called Dear Summer, which will be dropped like a lemonade album soon, but sure, so turn on your notifications. You can also catch me on Wednesday with the three best friends that anybody can have. And every Wednesday here on the Fan Club, I cannot wait to get into these next two episodes because they're actually my two favorite topics to date. You can also catch me. Do not forget, shout out to my brothers at Backstage Brawl. I will be joining their Saturday pregame brunch party, whatever we call it. It's going to be on Facebook Live, and we'll be showing them on September 30th. I cannot wait to hang out with them. Your girl is slowing down her booked and busy summer. So if you want to chat anything, if you want to talk about AEW, the four pillars, who's homegrown, you know, anything you want to talk about, I'm here. I'm open. I'm so excited to be in there. We've literally been at this a year, like almost a year now.
Mm-hmm.
And I couldn't think of doing this with anybody ever better. So like fun. The best people I could think to do this with. I've been doing this for a year. I'm happy. I'm blessed. I'm excited. Can't wait to do more. Can't wait to start singing Judas and Cody Rhodes theme songs at live shows with all of you someday, but surely. And I love you all. And I can't wait to do this again next Wednesday.
Love you guys. And we will see everyone next Wednesday, 7 p.m. Eastern. Sound off will be happening this Friday with KRISTA B and CRISPA CRISTINA. Thursday, second Thursday of every month. Get our merch on foryourwear.com. Shout out to Blue, who is racking up these clients.
Yes. Let's
get it.
Yes.
Shout out to Mr. Perry and the Wrestling Club. He had over 75 students express interest in the Wrestling Club this year. So he is going to be super busy. So make sure you support, buy their merch, send some love over to him. And I love all you guys. Thank you so much to our VIPs for watching. The Vaughns, the Keeps, the Rakarshas, the Andres, the Black Thoughts, the Noah. I'll send you the link, Noah, how to get our merch. Shout out to KRISTA B for joining us. Thank you to our producer and the rest of the crew, as always, for joining me every Wednesday. And on that note, we are out.
Good night.
Good night.